move the second stage of the Assembly and Executive Reform Assembly Opposition Bill and open the debate on the bill. Mr McAllister.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. Much has been talked about government and opposition in this place and many others for a long number of years now, probably right since these institutions were set up. The Deputy First Minister and perhaps even you, Mr Speaker, were a fan of the late great Seamus Heaney. And I will start with a quote from Seamus Heaney, and I quote, "Anyone with gumption and a sharp mind will take measure of two things, what's said and what's done." Mr Speaker, much has been said, and this is now the chance to see what can be done about it. There is a chance with this bill to truly reform. I want to, first of all, Mr Speaker, set out some of the reasons for the very real reasons why we need the Assembly and Executive Reform Bill. I think it would be you need to have been living abroad for quite a considerable time not to think that this Assembly and our Executive could do its business better. We only have to look and listen indeed to the words of the First Minister, the joint head of this administration, when he has described it in the past as being dysfunctional. And we have at times brought that level of dysfunctionality to an industrial scale. Where are we on big issues of welfare, of hospitals, of transforming your care, of funding our universities, the business community that are crying out for leadership? And you look at it, one of the key drivers that we could do in delivering a much better economic performance has been on delivering political stability. And I quote Kevin Kingston, the past president of the Northern Ireland Chamber, "Political stability is a key facilitator of economic growth, and Northern Ireland is already lagging behind the other regions of the UK in terms of recovery. The importance of political stability and the Northern Ireland Executive pulling together on the economy cannot be underestimated." And I think that's a key message, has to be about getting stability right. A key motivation for me pushing and moving this bill today has been about delivering a good governance that leads to political stability. All of the issues, Mr Speaker, that we have to tackle, that many members here feel passionately about delivering social justice in our most deprived communities and tackling educational underachievement and economic inactivity, yet we are not doing any of that, yet not delivering on any of those. We have come to the point, Mr Speaker, that effectively we either reform this Assembly or it will fail. And I don't say that lightly. We have been teetering on the edge now for a number of months. It's not the first crisis that we've hit. The old political adage about crisis, what crisis? We seem to be here more in crisis, which crisis? Because we're never quite sure which crisis is going to bring us down. Will we make it through to the end of the mandate? And we do have to be about much more than just surviving. This Assembly, we were told in 2011, Mr Speaker, that this was the term of delivery. We had survived 07 to 11. This has to be the term of delivery. And we all know the reason that this is here. This Assembly, these institutions, are born out of the Belfast Good Friday Agreement. I feel I'm almost one of the few unionists in this building that actually proudly says I voted yes in 1998 and I've never changed my mind. But does that mean that we want these institutions to be somehow frozen in time? Absolutely not. They were always envisaged to evolve. But the broad principles of that agreement about genuine power sharing and inclusivity, those are the principles in which I voted and I still agree and adhere to. It's how we deliver that normalisation of our politics, Mr Speaker, where parties present costed, realistic manifestos before an election. Our parties in the lead-up to that election, and And the apparatus of government might start to look at manifestos, might start to think who would form a likely administration, and after an election, a coalition comes together, agrees a programme for government, and they are bound in by collective responsibility. Instead, what we have for politics is the endless silo mentality, not only of the structure of our government, Mr. Speaker, but also of our politics. Silo because our departments think in silos, because politics makes them think that way. We think in our silos of a unionist versus nationalist bloc on every occasion. Instead, what we should be looking at is a government and an opposition to hold them to account. An opposition to hold them to account and provide our voters with an alternative administration, should they so wish. Because power in an elected and a representative democracy comes from the people. And we, Mr. Speaker, should never, ever forget that. I want to turn to some of the approaches to the bill. And in looking, Mr. Speaker, at this, there were several things came to mind early on. Could we do this without legislation? Could we do it just by standing orders? Could we, indeed, some would have suggested, Mr. Speaker, can we do it all, or should Westminster not lead on this issue? And I want to tackle that. So the bill in its structure is somewhat unusual, to say the least, in that it is structured in the parts that we can do, and built into that there is an Assembly and Executive Reform motion that we would also want to have debated, and there is endless, actually ample opportunities to debate, not only in committee should this bill receive the House's approval today, but also at consideration stage, further consideration stage, and so on and so forth. I want to take on some of the issues about doing it in legislation. And certainly if members that have gone through some of the and followed the debate on opposition for some time, and indeed refer members to their Research and Library Services pack on the bill, where the Lord MP, in moving amendments in the House of Lords, makes the case about and sets out the agenda that he would also be worried about anything that could take away from the powers if the Assembly were to do standing orders, that they would be easy to remove again. And that, Mr. Speaker, is the reason that they are much harder to remove if we do them in this bill. If we enshrine them in primary legislation, they are very hard for the gift of any executive. Lord Embry referred to them as like grace and favour for opposition. That is very, very difficult for Mr. Speaker, for a future executive at some point to take away the rights and powers and role of an opposition. That becomes very, very difficult to do. Now, I would point out, in rejecting doing it in the House of Lords, and this is why it comes very much to the structure of the bill, Mr. Speaker, in that both Lord McAvoy, speaking on behalf of the Labour opposition, and Baroness Randerson, on behalf of the government, the coalition government, that is, this is back in 2014, Lord McAvoy, and I quote, "The Assembly must reach a cross-community consensus on the creation of an opposition before Parliament can consider legislating in this way. Consensus cannot be created retrospectively, as this amendment would seek to do. It is for the Assembly to make the first moves towards creating an opposition." I'd also say in future debates where this, this was moved, Lord Alderdice refers to it as a bit of a catch-22 as to whether Westminster acts first or we in this Assembly act first. And those, Mr. Speaker, were the challenges that I faced in looking at this legislation, or the possibility of this legislation, was almost a chicken and egg situation into that which came first. It is very, very clear from the House of Lords debate right throughout it that, again, Lord McAvoy speaking, and I quote, a consensus must be reached in Northern Ireland before we can accept this amendment. If the Assembly were to pass standing orders to create an opposition and the Executive were to ask the Secretary of State to consider legislation, then it would be right to give the proposed amendment serious consideration. And again, Baroness Randerson makes it quite clear, it would not be appropriate for the Secretary of State to have authority over the Assembly's internal affairs, as this amendment suggests. In the view of this government, it is not appropriate for the Secretary of State to intervene in the internally in the processes of the Assembly. That gives you a flavour, in the House of Labour, Mr Speaker, right throughout the debate of what has been said. And again, in a further debate, Baroness Randerson, it is absolutely fundamental that the Assembly itself reach this agreement. The government see their role as facilitating the operation of opposition parties within the Assembly when the Assembly reaches that decision for itself. So right throughout the debates in the House of Lords, when Lord Enbi tabled those, two things I would ask the House to bear in mind is that Lord Enbi was making the point that a genuine concern about a future executive being able to take away or to change standing orders. This legislation makes that very, very difficult to do. By doing it in the way that I'm proposing to do it, makes it very difficult for a future executive to do. It is also abundantly clear that Westminster will not act on this without this Assembly, our executive making the first move. I would also, Mr Speaker, read from a correspondence I had with the Secretary of State, the Right Honourable Theresa Villiers MP, in response to a letter from myself on the 15th of December last year. And I'll just briefly quote the final paragraph. In principle, the government supports your suggested legislative approach in the Assembly. However, as some of your proposals involve changes to the architecture of the Belfast Agreement, the UK government can only give effect to those where it can be demonstrated that such changes command the broad support of parties in the Assembly. And therefore, Mr Speaker, that is why the approach of this bill in doing it and bringing it with an Assembly an executive reform motion attached to it.
Would the member give way? I thank the member for giving way, and I welcome the Secretary of State's commitment to listening to the views of the House. Given though, and given his enthusiasm for the Good Friday Agreement, and given that it was passed by referendum, does he not agree that it's not just the support of this House that should be required, but also the support of the people?
Mr Speaker, on that point I do disagree with him from a perspective of that the functions of this House and the way that our executive, our government, should do their business. I don't think it's necessary to go to a referendum. The Good Friday Agreement was at the end of a very troubled and difficult and turbulent time in Northern Ireland's history, where over 3,500 people had lost their lives. So it was a different, it was a sea change. There was also, for those in the Republic of Ireland, constitutional changes there. This is about saying to the people of Northern Ireland, we almost hear the message that you want a functional government, because I truly believe that people out there want to see this place work. They want to see it do more than just survive. And their chance for parties to put commitments in their manifesto and put that before the people, possibly on the 5th of May next year. But people will want to be going out voting on the basis that you're going to get something up and running with a functional executive, a functional government, and a robust opposition to hold that government to account. On looking at some of the key points, Mr. Speaker, throughout the bill, I would first of all say that, and there may well be some criticisms from some, that I've not sought to change any of the hunt. We are not at a place, quite frankly, Mr. Speaker, that we are ready to give up on the hunt in its entirety. We have not made the type of progress to normal politics in the past 17 and a half years that we've needed to make. In fact, it is well and truly argued we are more divided possibly than we were 17 and a half years ago. I sometimes look back, Mr. Speaker, over the last 6-7 weeks and wonder how on earth we did 1998. Because we seem to have lost any capacity for moving forward, for any spirit of generosity in our politics. So the reason I've sticking absolutely to hunt, because it respects those parties that have given mandate. I'm not about bringing parties that have a strong mandate and saying to them they should not be part of the government of Northern Ireland. The big challenge for them is to step up and be the government of Northern Ireland and to act responsibly like the Government of Northern Ireland. So that is why I have stuck with Don. I mean, Mr. Speaker, we know, and I respect Sinn Féin's mandate. I respect that they had 29 members elected here in 2011. In fact, I suspect there's only one party leader in here that wouldn't like to get 29 members elected at a 2016 Assembly election. So that is a tremendous mandate, so I'm not about excluding or trying to exclude one party from the government if their mandate so wishes. So you might well say then why the threshold? It is about making sure that those parties in government act, agree a government and act responsibly, and also that you reach a certain level to get that automatic right into government. And I know some parties will have concern about that. Again, Mr. Speaker, could I quote from the research back in Robert Dahl's back in 1966, but I think the example in it is good, that, and I quote, "By making the mistake common in ethnic conflicts of failing to distinguish inclusion in the political community from the inclusion in government. The arrangements in the Assembly have left us bereft of an effective opposition and anything to challenge executive dominance." So that, Mr. Speaker, is the reason for staying with the hunt, for committing to it. I'm not about excluding parties that reach a large mandate to get into government. That will be their right, and it is also their responsibility then to step up and to be the government. Also, on the issue of removing or renaming, the Office of First Minister, OFM-DFM becoming the Office of the First Ministers. Mr. Speaker, this has become one of the most divisive political issues, and yet for what reason? Everyone knows out there it is a co-joined, co-equal office. It is that in theory, one can't order a cup of coffee without the other one. So therefore, why do we not call it what it is? Call it the Office of the First Ministers. It is a joint administration, a joint holders. Everything about it is joint. One can't sign off on something without the other. That is where it is built in to do. Also, key to that is that a government parties that want to be in government should have to agree a programme for government with broad budget headlines. That is absolutely vital, Mr. Speaker. For too long, we have, just as the First Minister has pointed out, almost have survived this has to be about delivery. It has to be about delivery, whether that's in South Down or in Foyle or in East Belfast, and whatever the issues are tackling. It has to be about an effective government moving to a unitary model, not having these endless silos of governments, departments, not speaking to them. What I'm setting out here, Mr. Speaker, is a vision for genuine power sharing, not shared out power. What we have at the minute is not power sharing. It is shared out power where ministers can gang up and ministers can vote in the same way at an executive and be at a picket line later that day denouncing their ministerial colleagues. That is not something that I think can or indeed should be allowed to continue. All that has achieved for us is absolute public scorn. Public see and know and think dysfunctionality. If anyone ran any business in such a manner where one member's going off doing this and another member's going off in a completely different direction, it would not survive the test of time. And those also in building in collective cabinet responsibility. Could I also quote from the Owen Daly in the Irish Times in April 2014, and I quote, "Collective responsibility of government is not simply a political convention, but rather a legal principle enshrined in the Irish Constitution. While Article 28 of the Constitution states that the government must be collectively responsible to Dáil Éireann, it also stipulates that it shall meet and act as a collective authority. This means that observance of the rule is not simply a matter of political convention, as in Great Britain. In theory, it is legally binding and judiciable, at least in some instances." He also, in that article, went on to say, and I quote, "It prevents government by faction and ensures that executive power is located in a single accountable authority. For government to be effectively responsible, it must first be collective, a single unit, rather than a cluster of undisciplined factions. Indeed, the principle first developed in Great Britain as a means of wrestling power from king to cabinet." Now, I would stress, Mr. Speaker, if that line, for government to be effectively responsible, it must first be a collective, a single unit, rather than a cluster of undisciplined factions. I suspect that may ring some bells when people observe the Northern Ireland Assembly and how it might, how it does and how it has worked in recent times. So collective responsibility, moving to a unitary government, is absolutely vital to ensuring delivery and that governments speak as one voice. I've touched upon the threshold, and I think that is important, that we don't have this automatic entitlement to ministerial power and to getting into office, because if you want to truly get an agreed programme for government that means something, you will have to put some limits. People will have to sign up. Of course, parties falling below the threshold could negotiate their way into government, but they would, of course, be bound by collective responsibility. Mr. Speaker, turning to key reforms for this Assembly, I would just say it's included in the schedule that I would like to see the way we elect our Speaker changed. I would like to see it becoming very much the gift of the Assembly and members of this Assembly. I think I said that, Mr. Speaker, sir, in your own election, that it should be a gift of the Assembly, so and certainly not any personal dispute with you. But I think it is incumbent that the Speakership is seen and is completely, totally political independent, that a Speaker of whatever political party or background having to go back and to seek election in their constituency while not being able to write to ministers and having the same level of contact even in local press and all of the things that we do as constituency members. I think that's difficult. Difficult for a Speaker to take definitive positions, whether it's on planning or on other government policies, and maintain that neutrality. And I think, therefore, the way to do it is to have the Speaker lifted effectively out of party and constituency politics. A Speaker that is removed from that, his party gets a co-option. You'll be aware, Mr. Speaker, in Doyle Éireann, they reduce the number of seats that the Speaker's in the Speaker's constituency, and the Speaker is automatically returned. In Westminster, the Speaker faces virtually no real opposition from the main parties. I think in 2010, John Berger faced somebody that was in a campaign of representation for Buckinghamshire, his constituency. That, Mr. Speaker, somewhat limits and disenfranchises constituents living in Buckinghamshire, that the Speaker of the House of Commons couldn't write to almost, if you were, as one example put it, if you were going to concrete over all of Buckinghamshire, the Speaker could do very little about it, and that's something that I would seek to avoid. Turning to other changes in the opposition and the assembly reforms, having a leader and deputy leader of the opposition, I think that's key. It's a key to being and to actually saying people there is a huge role for parties to be in opposition. We have a mindset here, Mr. Speaker, that the only thing you need is one seat in the executive and you have great power. There is huge benefit in an opposition, huge benefits. And remember, an opposition working well, functioning well, today's opposition is tomorrow's government. That is the hope of what people would be. Indeed, having that, also having the chair and deputy chair of the Public Accounts Committee, just about every academic quoted in the research paper from Derek Burrell to Yvonne Galligan to Cathy Gormley-Heaney have talked about this change, and I think that would be a very, very welcome change. It's common practice in the Doyle, in Westminster, in Holyrood, in Cardiff Bay, all of the parliaments that you could mention, that is common practice. The rights to form a technical group, again, common practice in the Doyle. There's something like 23 or 24 independent members in Doyle Éireann currently. The right, and I think it is right and proper, Mr. Speaker, that there is some threshold set in that, that leaders of a single party don't automatically, by some electoral fluke, end up being leader of the opposition or deputy leader. But if you put a base of, say, 5%, as I'm proposing, that is 6 members. Now, it may just be convenient that there happens to be 6 of us in this corner, but I can assure the Speaker it's purely coincidence. But that between us, we would exercise those rights. At the minute, the 6 members here at this point in time cannot table motions within the Assembly, cannot have speaking rights or access to the Business Committee in that way. That is something I think that would help our democracy and would help give real meaning and substance. I've often said that in the old, my main criticism of the old Stormont Parliament was that you didn't have an effective opposition, so you had no ability of choice or change. The electoral system was changed at the 1929 election mainly to keep down that dangerous notion of independent unionists and to stop them getting too many seats. But that also gave us no ability to change our government. Too many people ended up being returned here completely unopposed for too long. That is not good for engagement in a democratic system. And that's why an opposition then, not having one then, did a huge disservice to Northern Ireland, to the body politic, and why these changes are essential now. So forming technical groups can be a huge part of that. The ability to ask topical questions, financial support, for example, Deputy Speaker or Mr. Speaker, I think looking at financial support, the reason I've written into the bill that we would move and give that to the independent review panel to look at not only salaries for leader and deputy leader of the opposition, but also to look at all of the allowances that are given to political parties. It may be of interest to some members to note that salaries of all ministers are paid by the Northern Ireland Assembly. I think it's somehow strange that the Assembly or the ministerial departments don't pay their own salaries. I think that part of a minister's salary should come from a department. It may also interest you know that costs this Assembly somewhere around £750,000 per year by the time you add in salary, national insurance contributions and pension contributions. I'm not saying all of that would have to come from departments, but certainly it would be an area that that should be looked at as to whether departments should not be incumbent for them to pay their own ministerial salaries. And I think there's scope to see what money could be reviewed, what money under our financial assistance to political parties should move from government to opposition. Also building in opposition day debates and changes to the budget committee. I've also, Mr. Speaker, built in to the bill that, and this is a hugely important line, that the bill would remove community designation from the Northern Ireland Act. Community designation, and I understand the reasons in 1998 that it was there. We were at a point of trying to move from conflict to consensus and building up trust. I'm not suggesting we've entirely the way there in building up trust, but further changes at the St Andrews Agreement actually have rendered community designation almost pointless. The original agreement had community designation was important for who got to be first or deputy first minister. As I've already said earlier in the debate, that is a sort of a phony war, if you want to describe, over who gets the first or deputy first minister. It's no longer used for that. It simply refers to now the largest party gets to be first minister. I want to rename that. Therefore, the only thing we now use community designation for is on cross-community votes, yes, and on who can run an event in this Assembly. And that's, other than that, that's all we need. My own personal view in running events in the Assembly is that this is our Parliament. It should be open to all, even those that don't like it, that don't want it here. But it should be open to a free and democratic debate. So therefore, the need for community designation is now, I feel, outlived any sense of purpose. It is now dividing us along sectarian lines, dividing us where it doesn't need to divide us. And I think that should be a welcome. I would say to members, to Hunt is your key in to government. Community designation in this and other keys serve of no purpose whatsoever. I'd also, turning to petitions of concern, but the changes I'm proposing to make to the petition of concern are to make it much more accountable as to needing the broader sense of support for triggering a petition of concern. I want to change the name of it to a minority community protection mechanism, but I also want it to need 30 signatures as it is at the minute, but I want that to come from three different groupings or parties. The reason, Mr. Speaker, for that, we have a tremendous track record of using petitions of concern, of abusing the petitions of concern right throughout this mandate. Now, one party can use them on their own, and there's and that's a problem. I would bring members to attention to some of the petitioning concern. It would appear now, in a rough count, in this mandate from May 2011, we have tabled about 100 petitions of concern. That's probably more than double, close to double, what we used in the preceding 13 years. So we're getting very common on them. Out of the 100 that have been tabled, 45, either the amendment was never moved nor no division was held on them. So again, we're down to a 19% strike rate effectively on this. So we are at, and the many of the things that you would see that they are tabled on, you would have to ask, what has been, where was the community protection in it? I will give Sinn Féin some credit on signing of petitions of concern, in that because they've needed to, they have sought to bring as wide a coalition into those petitions of concern as possible. I think in one of the last ones that they signed was on mandatory minimum sentencing, which of course you signed, the SDLP signed, NI21, the Greens and Ms Ogden signed. So you had a broad coalition to do that. Now, I made the point that you didn't actually need to do it because of the 55 petitions of concern votes that were held. Two-thirds of them, the petition didn't change the result. So only 19 of them did the petition of concern actually change the result. So out of the 100 that we've used, 19 changed the result. That's quite easy for me to do the percentages on. That's a pretty poor strike rate on that. So what are we protecting here? Something that now has become a matter of public scorn as to what we do. If there is something that you want to build in community, a protection mechanism, get the broad support. And I ask members to also, that ties in with the broad package of measures in this bill. It ties in with the fact that you will have an agreed government. Your most likely outcome of government could be a DUP Sinn Féin government. That they will be in government and shouldn't be petitioning concerning or asking for a different vote on their own government policy. If you have agreed government policy, they shouldn't be signing them. And also, the reason it builds it in is to stop any opposition as well tabling these things at will, that you have to have a broad coalition of support in agreement with that. And therefore, I think it gives very much the safeguards that we would all want to see take place, but it doesn't make it so easy that we table them on anything. Some, for example, that we've tabled, criminal justice bill, the establishment of an ad hoc committee. I think that was with welfare reform. The National Crime Agency. The National Crime Agency is actually a useful example of when a minister was asked to think again about something and negotiate and deal and get the SDLP primarily over the line. And now many parties in this House, with the allegations about NAMA and the role that the National Crime Agency are playing, in that we are welcome and glad to have the National Crime Agency here. AFI dual carriageway project was petitioned to concern right throughout the list, and so many amendments against welfare reform. And what that did show on that occasion of welfare reform was that when effectively the lead parties in government agreed on a policy, up until what happened in March, when they agreed on a policy, they could push that through. And again, calling in some of these, we would have been in an even worse position, Mr. Speaker, had the smaller parties at that time in government been able to block the budget. This House, you might well debate whether we have much of a budget at the minute or not, but we couldn't have actually passed a budget. Now, a government that cannot pass its budget, Mr. Speaker, and that's why I'd like to change it to a simple majority vote, a government that cannot pass its budget falls. That's the democratic norm around the world. If you cannot get supply, your government falls and you go to an immediate election. So therefore the case for changing the petition of concern and setting a higher bar to table such a mechanism, I think, is well and truly made, looking at the facts over this mandate. I also think the case for removing community designation and changing petition of concern are fundamental. The fact that we currently, Mr. Speaker, have effectively two tiers of MLAs when it comes to a cross-community vote. The eight members of the Alliance Party and Mr. Agnew, their votes do not count in a cross-community vote, and therefore the people who elected them are being disenfranchised in cross-community votes. It is now time to normalise this, to use qualified majority voting, to set a threshold of around 60% for that. I'm open to people wanting to change up that limit. I think 60% would have to be your minimum, but I think that's a key point. And I would say, Mr. Speaker, in response to, and no, Mr. Allister's not in for this part of the bill, the issues I have with, say, Mr. Allister's suggestions at the end of last week about two things. One, the Westminster government taking back executive power and this assembly becoming just sort of a scrutinising role. Do you know all that would do? And it might be fine on a very short temporary basis. All that would do is move every single member of this chamber into permanent opposition. The one thing we would unite around is that old saying of Ulster says no, because we would be saying no to everything. We would say no to about every proposal that involved any level of pain, any cut. We would be saying yes to more money would be the only thing that we'd be saying. And actually, Mr. Speaker, it lets each and every one of us off the hook. It lets every one of us off the hook, because I can go back to South Down and say, oh yes, I spoke out against that. I didn't support that. I didn't want to bring in prescription charges. I was against water charging. I was against welfare reform. It lets us all off the hook that we've no difficult decisions ever to make. The second point on moving to a permanent state of weighted majority voting, it permanently builds in the idea that we're not normal. I only want to see that done on exceptional circumstances, a weighted majority. It also is only about excluding one party. Whereas, as I said before, I respect your mandate. I say to Sinn Féin, I respect your mandate. I would love to lead a party that has 29 seats in this assembly, as indeed would many others. I respect it, therefore I get your right to be in government with that size of a mandate, and therefore it is right and proper that you should be there. So those are fundamental changes that I'm proposing in this bill. Mr. Speaker, very quickly going through the various clauses in the bill, I would say that we open it with the formation of an opposition and how an opposition is formed, the timing of creating that opposition. I would stress, Mr. Speaker, that in Clause 2 in the qualifying party needs a slight amendment, but I'm working on that so that every party effectively that doesn't that is above the threshold of 5%, i.e. six members, and is not in government, has not got a ministerial seat, qualifies to be in opposition, and then literally size of party. We then create the legal mechanism for you to hang the rights that those parties are entitled to. So it sets out, the bill clearly sets out, the membership of the opposition. It also excludes you, Mr Speaker, from being in either opposition or in government to maintain the neutrality of your role. Sets out that the opposition, of course, would fall if the executive fell as well. Creating a leader and deputy leader of the opposition, so the leader of the largest party in opposition, that would currently be Mr Nisbet, would qualify to be leader of the opposition in the current numbers, and the deputy leader would have to come from another group. If the six of us could agree, then some of us could be deputy leader. Who knows? Mr Nisbet might be leader of the opposition, I might be deputy leader of it. It'll be just like old times. I see Mr Kennedy's keen to put some distance between him and I. Mr Speaker, topical questions to the leader, from the leader and deputy leader of the opposition to the Office of the First Ministers, as it would be then known as, and to give them the first two topical questions each. Now, there was some concern, does that eat into too much of the topical question time? But I would ask members to remind members that the First Ministers are up for questioning twice as often as every other government department. And also building into that, that the chairs of committees also get the first topical question at their departmental question time. Enhanced speaking rights for opposition. I will look at section 2, where I've built in an entitlement of a minimum of 15 days. That is more, Mr Speaker, as a safety mechanism. If we had a very, very active executive with a very active legislative programme, I'm not sure whether any of us are anticipating that or not, but that is to set in a minimum that would have to happen. I will also be tabling an amendment around the speaking rights to put more of a distinction on that, that our speaking rights here should be given out by de Haunt on party strength, and then literally when the government is established and the opposition are established, a transfer, the opposition's party's rights would be lifted by 20% above their de Haunt calculations at the expense of the government parties, again to enhance the levels of scrutiny. I've talked earlier about the opposition rights to hold the chair and deputy chair of the Public Accounts Committee, as indeed around the world. Membership of the Business Committee, it is right and proper that opposition and indeed any technical groups that were represented in this chamber. Financial assistance to political parties, changing that and asking the Financial Review Panel to look at that and amend the Act to allow for an Assembly opposition to be contained in that. Also, salary for office holders in opposition. Again, look at amend slightly the financial, the Independent Financial and Standards Act, Northern Ireland 2011, for different salaries and allowances, and that to include not only ministers but office holders in opposition. Now, the Assembly and Executive Reform motion, this is the motion and this is the part that we have an opportunity to ask Westminster to make changes. As I've said earlier in the debate, Westminster will not do this without this chamber. And I personally, Mr Speaker, think that is right and proper. It is right and proper that we in this Assembly should determine the way and the changes that we want to see in our executive, in our Assembly, and that they stand ready to make the changes that if this Assembly and their Assembly and Executive Review and you, Mr Speaker, at the end of this bill were to write and ask the Secretary of State to do, that the Secretary of State would know that this Assembly, but all corners, had given its support, had lent its weight to that, and had actually said by a majority that they wanted to do this. And we go in to talk about in the bill about some of the way that motion is going to be tabled, and calls on the AERC to give regular updates. formation of technical groups within the opposition, I've talked about that, setting a threshold. I think that's sensible and wise to have that threshold set. Again, topical questions from chairs of the statutory committee. That adds the scrutiny that we expect in other legislators and other legislators around the world. That adds to that. It adds to that sense that a chair of a committee can ask a question of the health minister, of the employment minister, of the justice minister, of the first and ministers. All of that, I think, is important. Mr. Speaker, establishment of a budget committee. This effectively, and I think, to my own view, it ties in nicely if we do complete the reform of the size of government and the shape of government, the transfer of functions from government, that our assembly committee will change to mirror that. What I want to propose, and I accept that I do need to amend it slightly, but the policy direction, the policy intent that I've set out on doing that is very much about saying that we need to separate out from the Finance and Personnel Committee, keep with the Finance and Personnel all of the rating policy, the personnel, the voluntary access scheme, all of the stuff that belongs there, but actually change the game of our budget process. This is something that Mr. Cree has long campaigned for, has talked about in, I think, virtually every debate concerning the budget, that we need to improve our budget process. We also have a duty, and I know the Scottish Parliament use a budget committee to look at the explanatory and financial memorandum of every piece of legislation that comes before them. That's the type of level we need to be getting to. It's also that and lifting our game, quite frankly, on all of that information. I mean, one of our assembly training events, and Daniel Greenberg would be quite critical, shall I put it politely, of the standard of EFMs in this building, that we've a long way to go to catch up with our Scottish counterparts. The departments to be a single legal entity. I'm still waiting on some legal advice back on this, Mr. Speaker, and hope to have that very, very soon. I would anticipate making some amendments to this part of the bill, but the policy intent of this has to move away from the silo mentality of government and move to a single collective government machine where government and ministers all put their shoulders to the wheel. This is the direction of travel, Mr. Speaker, and every minister and every party in that executive and government has signed up to it and must deliver on that policy intent. That is what we have been so, so badly lacking and badly served by, to the point that Mr. Agnew was tabling a bill, and in fact is heading for further consideration stage on his bill, about getting government to work together to deliver services for children. And that's something that I want to see worked on. I want to see government work on a collective policy, collective cabinet responsibility. This helps make it. It helps get us away, Mr. Speaker, from the nonsense of one minister taking another minister to court, from the challenge of a minister taking other ministers to court. We've had that with then Minister for Finance Simon Hamilton taking Agriculture Minister Michelle O'Neill to court over rural development payments, and Minister Foster and Minister Durkin all taking each other to court. That is something that we have to move away from. We have to get to that collective sense of responsibility. When one minister speaks, they speak for the government. If the minister disagrees with government policy, they resign from the government. That is the reality if they disagree with government policy. Turning, Mr. Speaker, to the content of the schedule of the bill. This is the list that we want this assembly not only to pass today, but to look at, to look seriously at in the, if this bill is referred today to the Assembly and Executive Review Committee. And of course at consideration stage and further consideration stage, all of those are chances to amend. But I would highlight, Mr Speaker, that this is a carefully balanced package, I think, that delivers for us all. The motion may request that the concept of community designation is removed from the Northern Ireland Act. I think, Mr Speaker, that's hugely important to remove that sectarian element. Again, makes changes to the calls for changes to the 1998 Act and replace cross-community with weighted majority voting, and again the 30 signatures from different political parties and a threshold. Again, the safeguards are there. Changing, setting the limit at 60%. The changes to the election of the Speaker of weighted majority by secret ballot. The House of Commons elects the Speaker by secret ballot and then elevates the Speaker to effectively be MLA for Stormont and moves on to take. Also renames Office of First and Deputy First Ministers. Moves also not only from moving to a single unitary government, but writing into our ministerial code the collective ministerial responsibility. And I say, no matter how you look at this, as the earlier quote from Owen Daly puts it, it is passed down from Great Britain, from Westminster. It's about 300 years of convention at Westminster. If you disagree with government policy, you leave the government. It is in the Irish Constitution. If Sinn Féin were ever elected into the government of the Irish Republic, they would be bound in to act as a single unit and bound in by that constitution, by Article 28 of it. And that is an important change. We have to get to a point that we look and act and sound like a government of Northern Ireland and to make those changes. It sets out the threshold for nomination of minister, and if I take point 10 and 11 together as the schedule, it puts in that minimum of 16.6%. That's to future-proof it, Mr Speaker, in a smaller assembly of 90 members, or a possible reduction to 90 members. It also means that if we run to haunt as one piece, Mr Speaker, it takes away and moves and gives an incentive not only for a smaller party to haunt pick. Instead of being entitled to pick a minister, they get an extra chairmanship. They get a pick at a chair or deputy chair. That will give a higher percentage of chairs to your smaller parties. It brings them very much, meets the inclusivity criteria by giving them a very, very prominent role in the political community, in the opposition, in the Northern Ireland Assembly. And it gives an extra incentive to do that. Because I have to say, when you're the choice of, say, one minister, the impact that you can have, the endless complaints that we're treated very badly, you would be much better in opposition, chairing committees, preparing, scrutinising, and looking like an alternative administration at some point in the future. Again, the programme for government at 13 in the schedule, lengthening the time that we can have. I think the Stormont House agreement was 2 weeks that you'd have. I've suggested 4 weeks that you would have to negotiate. Again, Mr Speaker, this is something, if you recall, both in 2010 in the United Kingdom, it took the Lib Dems and the Tories four or five days to negotiate that. A standard time in the Republic of Ireland for Fine Gael and Labour to negotiate took maybe 2.5 to 3 weeks to negotiate. But it is vital to get a programme for government, nail down, meaningful, what you want in it, and the government collectively to put its shoulders to the wheel to deliver on that agenda. We expect it in councils. We expect when councils get together and put their agenda for for the council mandate. We expect in every other government, this is what happens. Governments, parties fight elections. Parties bring their manifestos and negotiate. Lead up to the UK 2015 election, the entire civil service machinery was looking at manifesto commitments from different parties, was looking, when it looked like we might have a coalition government, looking at what the negotiations might be, who might be in government, who might provide supply and confidence. Those are a normal part of the democratic functions. Also, the functions of statutory committee to change from advise and assist ministers in the formulation of policy to instead become one to scrutinise ministers. Point 15 of a simple majority vote for the budget. Mr Speaker, once we move to a simple majority vote for the budget, that is us starting to say that we are normalising our politics here. That is us starting to say we are normalising and ready and fit for the future to take on. We are setting out a collective approach to government. And I urge members, as I made the point earlier, this bill and all of the thoughts and processes, the discussions I've held with parties around this chamber, with parties in Westminster, with parties in the Dáil, I'm hoping if this is approved today to present to the Good Friday Agreement Committee in Dáil Éireann in a few weeks' time. All of those things have been with conversations about making effective government. This is not about excluding a party with a large mandate. This is about good, effective governance. Because I want more than anything else for my children who are at a young age, I want to be able for them to see a future in Northern Ireland. I want a vibrant economy with a growing private sector with a much reduced dependence on the state. I want to see that. I don't want to become a parent of an 18-year-old that gives the best advice is to get out of here. I don't want to be one of those that I'm bringing up my three kids with a view to having to leave. I want them to be part of it. And I say to everyone in this chamber, this is, out of the heart, is about putting a package together that works, that gives the balance of powers to government, to opposition. It will create a dynamic in a government that will actually can make decisions, can function, can deliver on transforming your care without all our government ministers out protest, can get an executive that can bring forward its shared education agenda and move ahead with that, can get an economic strategy, can, when it writes that the economy is at the heart of this government, does actually look as if it means it. That's an important change. I want, above all, a Northern Ireland Assembly, a Northern Ireland government, a Northern Ireland that works. And you know, Mr Speaker, regardless of your constitutional outlook, and goodness knows we voted every election as if it's a referendum on the border. We voted every election as if the border's up for grabs, even though it's not. 98 secures it that it's with the consent principle. That's why I was speaking to a friend who'd moved to Scotland some 14, 15 years ago, who would be very much a unionist, believes in Scotland, voted no in the referendum, but was happy to vote for the SNP because he actually thought they were doing a decent job for an agriculture. That's where we need to get, where policy matters, where manifestos matter, making Northern Ireland work. And that, on the constitutional agenda, if you believe, as I do personally, that we are best served being part of the United Kingdom, it is about making Northern Ireland work. Too long have we looked about as such a dysfunctional place, as something almost the basket case corner of the UK. I want to see us working. And the prize for us all in that is that if we look round, and the UK constitution in a state of flux, there is more powers that we could devolve here to a functioning assembly. There are many more tax-bearing powers, not just corporation tax, changes to income tax, bans of income tax, possible changes that Scotland are looking, that the Welsh are looking, that the Chancellor announced in his conference speech he's wanting to move and give to local government. In this whole idea of empowering English cities and the Northern Powerhouse, you can see right throughout this agenda that the real driving force is to devolve power closer to the people, and that is something that we should encourage. But for us to get that, Mr. Speaker, we need to be fit for purpose. This bill, I truly believe, delivers some of that. And if, Mr. Speaker, like many colleagues in this House, your outlook is to be part of an All-Ireland Republic, that's entirely fine. That's entirely legitimate. I respect that right, and I respect your ability to make those arguments. I might fundamentally disagree, but I say to you, if you are serious about ever making that argument, you have to make this place work. You have to look like you're a party of government. You have to look like you accept the responsibilities of being in government, and you have to rise to those challenges. I will end up with Mr. Speaker in moving the Assembly and Executive Reform Opposition, Assembly Opposition Bill. I'll end up with that quote I've used here before from John Fitzgerald Kennedy, that efforts and courage are not enough without purpose and direction. This bill gives the executive a way of getting that purpose and direction. It is incumbent then on the parties in that executive to get purpose and direction, to do the policies, to develop their agenda and to move on and to get elected and set that agenda. So let's all move on and change Northern Ireland very much for the better, and let's make it work. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much. And before I call the next speaker, can I remind members that question time is at 2 o'clock and it may be necessary to suspend this debate until thereafter. Can I call Raymond McCartney?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And can I first of all, in obviously the welcome and the second stage of the bill today, appreciate it's very obvious the amount of work which the proposer of the bill has put into it, and obviously the detail which he outlined today. And I know that he had the good grace and the courtesy to consult with our people, our party included. Certainly we would, in terms of today's, at the end of today's proceedings, will allow this to go to committee stage. I am a member of the Assembly Executive Review, and there's always already provision, I think, been made, if you like, second guessing the outcome of today's debate. The member, when he spoke about the need for this, now the member would be aware that we have said to him that we feel that many of the things which he has outlined here today can be brought about without the need for legislation, but that's something which I'm sure will be teased out as we take this forward. But in relation to this, and I think he quoted both the First Minister, or the step-aside First Minister at present, Mr. Robinson, and he also quoted Seamus Heaney when he said about this place being dysfunctional, and then had a reference to Seamus Heaney. And I'll paraphrase what is said then, what is to be done, so to speak, and that's fine. But sometimes when people talk about these institutions being dysfunctional, they sometimes forget the reason why and the history of the place. And indeed, Seamus Heaney, to quote him, actually once said, at home in Ireland we have a habit of avoidance. And sometimes when we talk about the dysfunctionality, the need for why the Good Friday Agreement came up with the particular structures which we have, then we often try to avoid that reason. Now, I'm not saying the proposer of the bill is. He certainly has outlined on a number of occasions that he's a supporter of the Good Friday Agreement, and indeed many times in many instances in the Assembly, and indeed by his actions he has shown that, and I welcome that. But even in terms of, I think, the reference to 1929, in terms of changing from proportional representation to first-past-the-post, whereas there may have been an intention to try and do with independent unionism voice, and I don't doubt that, but I think most observers would say that if you look at the level of representation, and certainly with first past the post, the nationalist representation failed dramatically, and as a result, discrimination was copper-fastened, and not only copper-fastened, but you had an opposition. No doubt you had a formal opposition, and an opposition with many of the speaking rights which you have outlined that are necessary in that type of system, but the history of opposition in that particular institution was far from impressive. I think they only ever were permitted to pass one piece of legislation, that was the Wildfire Act. So sometimes at the core of this, in any system, is about the intention of the people involved. And certainly when we talk about this, we will ensure that whatever legislation or whatever piece of work that goes through the Assembly, that it will have to be Good Friday Agreement proofed. And I say that, and perhaps in making a serious point, but perhaps somewhat tongue-in-cheek, let me say that we will be the gatekeepers, and we will ensure that there are no rogues or renegades who will try and undermine the principles of the Good Friday Agreement. And I don't include your good self in that definition. But that's the position which we will be taking as we take this forward. I think, because even, and you talked about it, and sometimes when people, and I understand when people say this, is this, we respect Sinn Féin's mandate, as if in some way that's a concession. Even when you're saying that some of the weighted majority is not designed to put Sinn Féin out of the executive, you know, and sometimes the not intentional, but the tone and the presentation of that, you know, is if we are somehow in a privileged position over and above all our elected representatives in this Assembly or elsewhere. We are here by the virtue and by the privilege that people have voted for us, and we certainly will vote or ensure that happens. And even, and he referred to the leader of the TUV in his presentations, you know, last week, and I think you described one of them where you would have English ministers here being scrutinised by the Assembly, you know, that somehow you were saying, and quite rightly, I think you were saying that was putting everybody in the opposition. But the one thing, and I think it's, you know, it just gives it the intention. See, that would ensure it's Sinn Féin's not the executive. So sometimes people are prepared to cut off their nose despite their face. And also because I've heard the said member time out of number saying that in the democratic norm, the democratic principle is that you have to be in a position to vote a party and an outer government. But that model, the British Liberal Party don't stand here, the Liberal Democrats don't stand here, and when the Conservative Party do stand here, it's with derisory votes. So he, in one hand, says you have to have the ability to vote somebody out of power, but he doesn't want to extend that to the people here in the North. So that's why sometimes, and I've made that point about intention, there are people who would be very, very comfortable with the idea of putting up any model as long as Sinn Féin weren't in the executive. The Good Friday Agreement is what we will protect. The Good Friday Agreement allows the people to decide who's in the executive. And the dysfunctionality is all our issues, which I think can be teased out, and we have no issue with trying to tease that out. As I've said, under the terms that were agreed under the Stormont House Agreement, there is provision for an opposition. And even thinking the laying out of your clauses, I think I'm not saying you accept that, but certainly in broad terms you're saying, you know, standing orders must make provision, which in our opinion would say the standard orders could be amended to bring in many of the suggestions which you have made, because we are not opposed to the idea of opposition if people so wish and so desire to be that. Yes, I will indeed, yeah.
That comment that there is provision to do these things, I've read the Stormont House Agreement. If his party is keen to implement many of these changes, why has he not brought them forward as a proposed change to standing orders?
I mean, I think that two aspects of it is that we wouldn't be in a position to do it on our own. I think when Mr. McAllister was speaking this morning, I think he made that very well point. You're better when you're trying to change things here in particular, they have a sort of consensus and a collective. So there's an implementation group around the Stormont House Agreement. So hopefully coming out the other end of that implementation group will be many aspects of the Stormont House Agreement which have been agreed and in our opinion can project this forward. One of them will be opposition. If we took a position to change standing orders, then our parties could block it. So what would be the point? Is it not better that we all agree that there's a need for it, what the shape of it, what the content and what the form will be, and then we'll have a better success. I don't mean this in a dismissive way. See, The easy thing to do sometimes in politics is to run to the microphone and get a soundbite. But what you want to do here is not get the soundbite, but get something that will bite and have some sort of opposition as we go forward. Again, just in terms of the schedule, and I see the, you know, the import and the content, but there are aspects of that which we feel would require good scrutiny in terms of irrespective of what position you take, but there's aspects of it, in our opinion, need Good Friday Agreement proofed, because there's just some of the aspects perhaps hands too much power and too much responsibility to the British Secretary of State in terms of what legislation you might say to, or say to someone, and we would be opposed to it, you know, bring in legislation, but you don't give them any boundaries what they do it, then they come back with something which you might not agree, and then you'll find yourself in a position that you can't do too much about it. But in terms of the broad principles and the presentation which the member made here today, then we have no issue with giving this approval today, certainly in terms of the scrutiny and at committee stage, then certainly we want to play our full part. But I do put that sort of broad proviso, and the member's well aware of that, is that we feel that many aspects of this does not require legislation that can be brought about by changing standing orders. Guru Mila Mayogat, Colin Cooler.
Guru Mila Mayogat. Question time begins at 2 p.m. I already mentioned, so I'm suggesting that the House takes its ease until then. The debate will continue after question time, and the next member to speak will be Mr. Sean Rogers.
Members, we are now returning to the debate on the Assembly and Executive Reform Bill, and I call Mr. Sean Rogers. Mr. Rogers.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to speak at the second stage of Mr. McAllister's Executive Reform Bill. Mr. McAllister, in his opening remarks, commented that this was a vision for genuine power sharing. I think nobody could disagree with that, a vision for genuine power sharing. If this bill is part of a mechanism to build on the Good Friday Agreement and ensure better government, then we will be supportive. Just one point I would like to challenge Mr. McAllister on, and that is his mathematics. I thought there was an announcement coming on that some of the technical group had joined the Ulster Unionist Party again, because I know it's a hypothetical situation, but it would be ourselves would be the largest group in the opposition if it was. But maybe there's an announcement coming on aside down. Yes, I will, yeah.
I'm not sure whether he's just about to announce that the Minister of the Environment's resigning.
We'll wait and see the next of action. The SDLP has been consistent in the nature of an opposition and our overall support for its implementation. If you would allow me, Mr. Speaker, I reiterate once more our position and the general principles of the matter. We in the SDLP believe that an opposition should be built into the structures of the Assembly, but that opposition should remain optional. We have argued that there should be no mandatory opposition, and if one should exist, it should be guaranteed, and as Mr. McAllister said, I was glad to hear that the de hunt entitlement would be guaranteed under power sharing arrangements if they choose to claim that entitlement. In previous discussions on opposition, the SDLP have argued that an official opposition should be open to parties who are entitled to take a seat in the executive and choose not to. If more than one party makes this choice, naturally we would expect the two largest of them to form the official opposition. For an effective opposition, Mr. Speaker, the SDLP believe that it is crucial that the privileges afforded to the parties forming an official opposition in the Assembly must seek to empower it to hold the executive to account. An official opposition must be able to hold the executive to the highest level of scrutiny in order to serve its role as a genuine alternative to the government, and therefore must be sufficiently funded in order to do so. We welcome the Bill's provision that seek to empower an official opposition. We welcome that under Clause 7, that the first and second topical questions put to OFM, DFM during question time will belong to the leaders of the opposition. We further welcome under Clause 8 of the enhanced speaking rights for the opposition and the minimum guarantee of 15 days per year for the opposition business. Mr. Speaker, in an Assembly with a functioning opposition, we would expect an Assembly committee memberships to be altered and appropriately weighed to reflect the opposition parties. We welcome the provision that under Clause 3, which would create the provision for the rights of the opposition to chair the Public Accounts Committee like other jurisdictions. If parties are given the practical recognition and sufficient funding, it will enable them to scrutinise the executive and to provide a viable alternative to the government. As agreed in the Stormont House Agreement, we believe funding the party-appointed research and assistant posts are critical. Legislative scrutiny must also vastly be improved by Assembly-appointed legislative drafters to assist the opposition parties with scrutiny of amendments to drafting of bills. The SDLP would expect to see the reforms of the institution proposed by Mr McAllister to remain faithful to the tenets of the Good Friday Agreement. Anything that erodes or dilutes anything in the Good Friday Agreement, the SDLP will not be in support of. And bearing that in mind, the thresholds seem quite high at the moment. As previously recognised by the Northern Ireland Miscellaneous Draft Provisions, opposition must be consistent with the principles of inclusivity and of power sharing that are central to the Belfast Agreement. The bill as it stands, as it will be implemented, must reflect Northern Ireland's unique situation as a post-conflict society, while further reflecting on the historical power-sharing nature of our institutions. Therefore, the SDLP have welcomed Mr McAllister's previous recognition of the importance of a review mechanism built into the Strand 1 of the agreement and the ability of an official opposition and power-sharing to exist as complementary to each other. To this effect, we had hoped that the opposition would not consist of two of the same denominations, but instead be a compromise of two separate outlooks. When considering the historical and ongoing difficulties between Northern Ireland's main communities, we remain apprehensive on the call of the Schedule 1 to remove the current community designations. Still, we are prepared to engage with the Bill on this aspect as it moves forward. We also have reservations about the size of the technical group. Seems quite small that 5 or 6 members would form a technical group. Ultimately, Mr Speaker, the SDLP would hope that all provisions for official opposition be guided by power sharing, reconciliation, equality, partnership, prosperity and, above all, accountability. These are the principles of good faith and of good government in Northern Ireland. They are the standards that the people of Northern Ireland demand of their government, and they are areas in which the current regime have failed. At this point, I would like to quote from one of the architects of the Good Friday Agreement and a good friend of ours, Seamus Mallon, when he said, "Our primary responsibility is to be good ancestors for those who come after us, good ancestors who leave our descendants a society at peace with themselves and their neighbours and serve by a political process which has integrity and vision." He goes on then to say that he said in 1999, and he said again now, "The people in Northern Ireland belong to each other, that the we's and the they's will sink or swim together." Mr Speaker, the SDLP remains resolute to the Good Friday Agreement and supports the principles of this bill as they currently stand. We look forward to engaging in the bill at the committee stage. Thank you.
Call Mr Danny Kennedy.
Mr Deputy Speaker, can I welcome the opportunity to speak on this private member's bill today. The bill proposes reform to a number of areas of the Assembly and the Executive, but it is true to say that it is probably the proposals around opposition structures that will receive the most attention during the passage of the bill. Formal opposition structures are something that, of course, are taken for granted in most democracies. Outside of Northern Ireland, the power to vote a party in or out of government is something that is taken for granted in other parts of the United Kingdom and in any other democratic nation virtually on the planet. However, we in Northern Ireland are still playing catch-up in terms of the Assembly. Mandatory coalition and 5-party government were required to get us over the initial hurdles of devolution. Yet, 17 years on from the Belfast Agreement, the Assembly has not evolved with society, who clearly crave an official opposition here in this chamber. And we can't continue to deny the population the right to remove a party from power or vote one into government. The structures created to draw in as many people as possible into the democratic process now sadly seems to be turning people off. And the voters' frustration at being unable to send a message at the ballot box grows with each election. We only have to look at and study the turnout percentages to see that. Mr. Deputy Speaker, my party has long called for opposition structures to be created in this Assembly. We recognise the important role that they play in holding government to account and offering the voters an alternative. And if we're really serious about transitioning out of an institution that staggers along from one mandate to the next and into one that delivers for the people of Northern Ireland, then it is vital that we put in place a mechanism to ensure a party or parties to form an opposition. Having a formally recognised opposition and everything that comes with it, such as enhanced speaking rights, supply days and committee roles, I think can help revitalise this Assembly. And offering the opportunity for effective scrutiny of the Executive, rather than the Executive being left to largely scrutinising itself. Mr. McAllister did refer to the effort made by the Ulster Unionist Party in the form of Lord MP of Shanton, who tabled amendments in another place to the Northern Ireland Act to try and put measures in place for opposition structures. Our preferred option has also been to enshrine the right of the opposition within legislation, as we do believe that simply changing standing orders leaves the future of existence in the opposition in the hands potentially of the largest parties in this or any future Assembly. And let's not forget that the Stormont House Agreement that promised formal opposition structures by March this year, and here we are in October, and still no opposition rights for parties not in the Executive. Briefly, turning to the bill itself, it raises questions for us, and we look forward to being able to interrogate a number of other areas further at the committee stage. I want to touch on a couple of issues, areas of the bill, but there is quite a way to go yet in terms of this bill, and I'm sure we'll have the opportunity to scrutinise and debate all aspects of the bill further in the coming weeks and months. We'll want to look further, for instance, in detail as to who qualifies for members of the official opposition, and we would largely be of the view that there should indeed be a threshold. On the proposals around technical groups, we would have concerns at this stage about this proposal and the potential that a mechanism designed to enhance democracy could end up working against that principle. Titles for those within the opposition, we remain, I think, unconvinced about the need for official titles within the opposition. We would point to the Scottish Parliament and the fact that each party within the opposition has their leader and spokespersons without the need for formal titles. And salaries, it would be our view that the opposition should be formed on a cost-neutral basis. We would instead encourage a look at restructuring how current resource is allocated. But again, I'm sure this is something that we can look at in more detail during the consideration, the committee and consideration processes. Renaming the office of OFM-DFM, we note this fundamental proposal. It's no secret that the Ulster Unionist Party remain unhappy with the changes made to the election of First and Deputy First Ministers at St Andrews. That change was something that only serves to promote sectarian headcounts. Briefly to close, we remain totally committed to seeing the introduction of a mechanism to allow an opposition to be formed in this House. We're also supportive of reform of the Assembly and Executive, and raising the level of accountability of elected members. So therefore, Mr Deputy Speaker, we look forward to contributing positively to the debate in future as this bill proceeds through the House. Thank you.
I call Mr Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. We welcome this bill as far as it goes in its present form. It's like any other bill, it's going to need some attention. I have a feeling it may get more attention in particular directions than a bill might normally expect to get, but we'll see where it goes. I think Mr McAllister deserves congratulations as being the person who finally brought this before the House, and not before time. And he was good enough to consult, excuse me, Mr Speaker, with other parties, including ourselves, so we have some background as to what his thinking is. And I would also congratulate him on his presentation of the bill today, which I thought was excellent. But this is really it's a test of the Assembly's will as well. You know, it's okay to bring a bill in second stage. Everybody says, yeah, we'll give that a fair wind. It's when we get to the next couple of stages, we'll really see what's going to happen. And I can't help thinking that today, for instance, the elephant in the room is actually the absence of the DUP, because we don't know. Sorry, Paul, I don't mean to refer to you in that way, but they're not here. We won't know what their thinking is until perhaps some future stage. But you know, any bill that would want to get rid of community designations or end the iniquitous system of petitions of concern and move to a wider majority is not going to get much opposition from the Alliance Party, because we're totally with you on that. And in fact, Alliance Party thinking actually runs quite a long way through this bill. There's not too much there we would disagree with. In fact, we're so much in tune, John, you might think of coming to us to form an even bigger technical group, you know. Well, that's all right. The offer's on the table. But as far as opposition is concerned, yes, of course, we're in favour of a structured official opposition. I think we shouldn't forget that the reason we have the slightly contrived, wacky system that we have here nowadays is because opposition didn't work. So whatever form of opposition hopefully would come out of this, it needs to be very carefully thought out, and not just some kind of numbers game to, you know, manipulate the particular situation and particular party strengths within the Assembly. The clause that introduces a figure, I think it's on the schedules actually, of 16.5% representation before you qualify for a ministry, that's an interesting one, because that would actually bring us back on the current strengths to two-party government, which is pretty much what we have anyway. But you know, it would actually the US Union, the SDLP and ourselves. Need to be a bit of thinking about that. It's not to say that we wouldn't relish an opposition role. I'm sure the Ulster Unionists, because you've often demanded it, would probably say the same thing. But, you know, we have a reservation about that, let's put it that way. Just to look at one or two of the clauses. Clause 9, the opposition right to chair the Public Accounts Committee. Well, that's universally accepted in most civilised legislatures. It was actually the case here. When I came here in 2007, the assumption was that the biggest party not in government, namely us, would achieve the chair of the Public Accounts Committee, but it went to Sinn Féin, because DUP and Sinn Féin agreed. And I think you're going to have to get over that kind of thing. And if this works, and if there's an assumption that the two biggest parties here will remain the two biggest parties, you're going to have to think about some of these things, you know, because once you're in power, you can do pretty much what you like. The clause 19. Yeah, this is the establishment of a budget committee. Well, okay, it sounds like a nice idea. We do have a finance committee. You know, I haven't been totally convinced yet as to why that the finance committee shouldn't continue to do its scrutiny of finance, which is what it's partly set up for. And I could just make the point that Westminster has a, you know, at the time we had the ad hoc committee on welfare reform, Robin Swan and myself went over to see the chair of their appropriate committee. But their standing committee on that sort of thing actually scrutinises everything that goes through Westminster. It's a standing ad hoc committee. So there may be some compromise there. But we'll see. On the schedules, schedule item 10, what was that? Oh, sorry, that was the threshold for nomination of a minister. I won't labour that one. The schedule number 15, the motion may request any budget may be approved by a simple majority. Well, you know, if your important decisions are going to require some measure of cross-community support, with or without designations, I would query whether the budget should be allowed to go through on a simple majority. It doesn't sound right, but, you know, they're just random thoughts at the minute, because, like everybody else, we're going to have a good look at this. Yes, number 7 in the schedule, this is about the Speaker and how the Speaker's elected and how what happens to him at the end of the mandate. It seems, if I read it right, it means that the Speaker will be elected by a secret ballot of the Assembly. Well, fair enough. Once we come to the end of the mandate, he won't be allowed to return to the Assembly as an ordinary member. That's correct me if I'm wrong, John, but that's my reading of it. And that his only avenue back into the Assembly would be if he was re-selected as Deputy Speaker or as Speaker. It doesn't sound like a job for a young man, especially one with political ambition, you know. So it could be that my generation and that of others would be the most likely to obtain the rank of Speaker and then go off into the sunset. It doesn't... Not totally happy about that, I think. I'm not quite sure how Westminster does it or anywhere else, but it sounds...
Drag him to the chair.
Okay, I can't drag him out again.
Yes, you'd be willing to be dragged.
beyond that, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I don't have very much to say about this at this stage, but, you know, like everybody else, we will be scrutinising it, and it's going through the Assembly and Executive Review Committee, so I'll have some input there. But you know, it is a challenge to the Assembly. Are we going to finally start to mature, to grow up? Mr. McCartney said it had to be Good Friday Agreement proofed. Well, that's fine. I would support the broad principle of that. But the Good Friday Agreement doesn't have to be set in stone. If there's things there that we can move away from, move on from, let's say, by agreement, go ahead.
I was listening to what Mr. Lunn was saying there about he referred to the establishment of the Budget Committee. And indeed, that's something that the SDLP has called for. But, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is there any point in establishing a budget committee when the financial process has not been reformed? Because if we do not reform the financial process, the timescale that exists at the moment for the budget is such that it's presented almost as a fait accompli and pushed through the Finance Committee by accelerated passage. So therefore, in order to have effective budgetary scrutiny, there must be a financial process which lends itself to that.
Yes, well, I wouldn't disagree with any of that, but at the end of the day, a committee has to scrutinise the budget, and so does this Assembly. Whether it's a newly formed budget committee or the present system, and I agree with you that it always ends up as a bit of a rush, but that's because the agreement has taken so long to sort out an agreement on the budget, and that's because of the system that we currently have, where it can be blocked by one side or the other. So we need to get away from that. We need to get into some sort of a corporate system, particularly where there's a programme for government established and agreed before we choose our ministers and so on. It's all there in John's bill now. I think he has some very good ideas or some not much that we would disagree with. I have a feeling that the silent majority over to my left will probably have a lot more to say about it if they ever come back and the time comes. But in the meantime, I'd hope. I do hear whispers that the DUP are not totally opposed to this so much, and Mrs. Bradley's face to see any clue. But if they can come back to this assembly and say that they're prepared to countenance the end of petitions of concern, for instance, and community designation, well, it's not that long ago the AERC produced a report on petitions of concern. Indeed, you were part of it. And well, it would be a quantum leap, I would say, for the DUP, and probably actually for Sinn Féin as well, to agree to end that particular iniquitous business-blocking nuisance of a system. But we'll see. We'll see at the next stage. Maybe about time we'll be back in full cry again, and we'll see what the DUP actually think. But in the meantime, I thank Mr. McAllister for bringing the bill to the House. I think it's a good document, a good potential piece of legislation, and hopefully the bones of it and the meat of it as well, for that matter, will survive this process and we'll end up in a better place at the start of the next mandate than where we are now.
Call Mr. Jim Allister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Is it not quite staggering that in a system that takes on to itself the title of democratic in seeking to describe these institutions, that we even have to have a debate about whether or not we should have one of the most elementary components of a democratic chamber, namely an opposition? It does beggar belief, and indeed presents as a most telling commentary on these institutions, that we even have to have this debate. This novelty of the idea that you just might allow, in the right circumstances, within these institutions, that strange and dangerous thing called an opposition. Oppositions are fundamental to anything that passes properly as democratic in terms of institutions. And the very fact that these institutions ban opposition, that they have existed, if that's even the word, for the last 16, 17 years, by suppressing the very right to have an opposition, speaks volumes of these institutions. It really should be, for anyone, a no-brainer as to whether or not, within governmental structures, you have an opposition. If you want to take on to yourself the assignation of being democratic, then there really is nothing to debate. Of course, there should be an opposition. And shame on these institutions that for years they have sought to suppress and deny that basic democratic component of democracy. So any bill that has the temerity to talk about creating an opposition has to be a bill moving in the right direction. Then we hear from some contributors, like Mr. Rogers, well, as long as it doesn't depart from the Belfast Agreement. Well, of course it is the Belfast Agreement which spawned the denial of opposition, which built the very structures which suppress that fundamental democratic right. And to hear the SDLP talk in those terms and demonstrating they are shackled so mindlessly to the Belfast Agreement and hope that an opposition wouldn't upset any of that. Take a look around. The Belfast Agreement has failed. It isn't working. The very state of this House this afternoon is proof positive of its perpetual failure. How many times have these structures not had to be sticky plastered back together again, propped up until they lurch to the next crisis? And there are ongoing efforts yet again to produce another patch up until the next crisis. Now, the reality needs to be faced at some point. The penny needs to drop with some people that the institutions created in the Belfast Agreement have had their day. They haven't worked. They're not worth saving. And that the only way to go forward is to embrace wholeheartedly the fundamental elements of democracy, which includes acknowledging the right to have an opposition, which includes the right to change your government, which includes the right to vote a party out of government. But to even have to debate whether or not we need an opposition, even for someone as case-hardened as me, to the perversity of these institutions, I find it staggering that this even requires debate and is commentary in itself on the absurdity of what has been built within these institutions. So, of course, we need an opposition. I wish this bill had gone much further. I wish this bill had addressed another central perversity of the Belfast Agreement, that in some crazy way you can have a mandate as of right to be in government. You can't. We can all have a mandate to be in this House, but short of a party commanding an overall majority in itself, and that's not going to happen, no party in a democracy can have a mandate as of right to be in government. And that, of course, is the fatal building block of this failed executive. And it's a building block which Mr. McAllister's bill chips a bit at, but maintains as a cornerstone by saying that provided you get 18 MLAs, then you, as of right, are entitled to a place in government. You, as of right, cannot be voted out of government, whoever you are. You, as of right, have a mandate to be in government. That is nonsense. You can't have a mandate as of right to be in government. That's why the proper path in a democracy to being in government, where no party is big enough to form government on its own, is the path of voluntary coalition, where those who together can agree what they're going to do about the key social economic issues, whoever they are, they can make the mathematics work, they govern. Those who can't, whoever they are, they form the opposition. Unless and until we get away from the artificiality which has entrenched sectarianism in Northern Ireland. Because the one thing the Belfast Agreement has done, it has entrenched the idea of tribal politics, that you must have two large groups, one mutually vetoing the other. Less and until we dispense with that nonsensical, stultifying, sectarian approach and embrace the fundamental elements that demote democracy anywhere, then this Stormont is not going to work. And therefore I say, I am disappointed that Mr. McAllister only tinkers with that issue and maintains the position of this absurd notion of as of right being entitled to a place in government. As of right, places in government has no place in democratic institutions. No place where no party is capable of governing on its own. Coalition of the willing is the only legitimate democratic path to tread. So this bill, in underscoring that facet of the failure of these institutions, is disappointing. But returning to the question of the formation of an opposition, now, I apologise I wasn't here during Mr. McAllister's opening speech. I think he did, I'm told, give some recognition to the need to revisit Clause 2 in terms of the definition of a qualifying party, because I was going to point out in this debate that as this bill currently reads, and if you read it across the election results that are represented in this House today, then it couldn't deliver you an opposition, because there'd be no qualifying parties if that was the route to delivery. Because SDLP have 14, they would need 18. Welsh Union is 13, they would need 18. Alliance of 8, they would need 18. So none of them, under the terms of the bill as drafted, would be qualifying parties in Clause 2, because they haven't been in a position where they have rejected their entitlement to an executive position. Yes.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I'm grateful to the member, and I did. I know he was detained otherwise with important stuff around our ambulance work that he's involved in. Literally, the proposed amendment that is to be finalised, but it would read something along the lines of leave all out after minister and insert and comprise of more than 5% of the total members of the Assembly. So therefore, it would remove that the section 18.2, those lines all about being able to nominate ministers, and just make sure that the party qualifying was over 5% or 6 members of the Assembly. So hopefully that clarifies.
It does, and I think it radically improves Clause 2 and makes the possibility of the creation of an opposition more viable, because it seems to me fundamentally right that any party outside of the executive should be entitled to form and to be part of an opposition when formed, and therefore I welcome the fact that what the sponsor has said in that regard. I think that's very important. Could I also say, in relation to technical groups, I think there is a place for technical groups. I was a member of the European Parliament for 5 years. I sat in a technical group. It varied in numbers, but usually around 30 members of the House were members of a technical group. And it was a group in name only. It was made up of disparate individuals, but it gave those individuals a say and a reflective input into speaking rights and times and all of that, and I think that's appropriate. One exists in the Dáil Éireann in Dublin, and they exist in many European parliamentary institutions. I think there certainly is a role for them. Of course, in my role in this House, as a member of the Procedures Committee, I attempted, I think not once but twice, to advance the cause of a technical group in the Procedures Committee and brought a proposal to that effect to see it roundly voted down by everyone else. So unless there's been a sea change in terms of attitude to the existence of a technical group, and I hope there has been, then it may, within this bill, be more theoretical than realisable. But I do trust that a favourable consideration will be given to that, because I think it does provide the opportunity to strengthen the contribution which individual members have to make in this House. There are other things within this bill that I think are interesting. I think it is right to address the fact that in law and in practice we have joint first ministers. I think that's what we have, and that's what we should say, and it's but to save some blushes that we don't have them called joint first ministers. But that's what they are. So why should the legislation live in denial of that fact? I don't see that it should. I think the suggestions about the election of the Speaker, I like the idea of the Speaker being elected by secret ballot. I'm not so sure about the putting him out to graze idea that Mr. Lunn was talking about after his 4 or 5 year term, but I think it shows some inventive thinking, and it's worthy of consideration. All in all, though it is clear that the first part of this bill, namely that which can be done by standing orders, really to have bite and effect with the other changes, requires the schedule to be passed, and that would require defeating the ever-present obstacle of petition of concern. So the vested interest of the few may well deny the desire of the many, not for the first time. But I commend the member for some of the ingenuity in the bill, for bringing the bill. I know that this has been a torturous path in terms of presenting this legislation, but I think he has persevered and he has brought the bill to this point, and I think deficient as it is in terms of my long-term ambitions, it's a start in the right direction, and I think it deserves a fair wind. Thank you.
Call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And I would like to also commend Mr. McAllister on bringing this piece of legislation forward. I know the difficulties in preparing a private member's bill, and as the sponsor made reference to, I've will soon be having the third reading of my own bill. But it's a difficult piece of work to take on such a large piece of work as well in terms of reforming the institutions. It's certainly ambitious, and indeed it's innovative, in that I suspect some of his proposals, when he took them forward, he would have been told, you can't do that. It's not within the competency, and I don't know who helped him with it or how he got to this stage, but the mechanism of the Assembly and Executive Review motion is certainly a new way around that for me, and I think is to be commended in bringing that element of it forward. I think the failure of the executive, or the Northern Ireland Government, if we were to pass this bill, we could start referring it to it as, is being shown by the dearth of legislation that we're currently addressing from the executive and from government departments. And indeed, it is private members' bills, like my own, like John's, and indeed like Mr. Allister's. Today we seek to create, Mr. McAllister seeks to create an opposition, but I think in these benches, despite the barriers of these structures, we are doing all in our power to create an effective opposition in bringing forward legislation in the absence of legislation coming from the Northern Ireland Government. I think it's an example of the failure of the Assembly and Executive Review Committee that, whilst there seems to be a large degree of support for some of the proposals that those who sit on that committee could not agree to bring forward similar proposals. And I know Mr. McCartney made reference to maybe legislation wouldn't be required for all elements of it. And if there are other ways, then let's explore them. But again, it has taken an opposition member to bring forward the bill that might act as the spur to make those changes happen. One of the aspects of the bill that I very much welcome is the increased speaking rights for an opposition, not just from a point of view of self-interest. I do like the sound of my own voice, but I don't think it needs to be put in legislation that I should speak more. But I think the fact, if you go back, for example, for when the programme for government was presented to this Assembly, not one member outside of the executive parties got to question the First Minister or the Deputy First Minister in the presentation of the programme for government. Now, that is part of the fundamental of democracy, that you challenge the programme for government, that the opposition challenge the programme for government. Yet, it was not within the Speaker's power to grant those in the opposition benches speaking rights and to question the First and Deputy First Minister on the programme they outlined. Instead, what we had was the farce of pre-prepared questions from backbenchers of the government party asking effectively, why is this such a great programme for government? That's not democracy, and that's not evidence of a functioning assembly. So I think the speaking rights is necessary, because again, people might ask, well, what difference will a formal opposition make? Well, that's one of the differences. The right to challenge, the right to speak, and the right to bring forward motions, is essential. Collective responsibility. Examples were needed as why collective responsibility is important in any government, I think Northern Ireland can provide the examples. When you have one minister taking another minister to court at taxpayer's expense to play out disagreements that should be taken around the executive table, should be resolved and should be moved on from. Instead, we have our dirty linen played out in the courts and party political squabbles played out in the courts at taxpayers' expense. Again, that is an example of failure, an example of where things need to change in Northern Ireland. And some people say, Mr. Alistair is fond of saying, we have no opposition. I think sometimes the problem we have is we have everyone in opposition. So when one minister makes a decision, another minister or another party of the executive challenging that publicly, and that's why I think we have such problem even in terms of the language, in terms of holding executive parties to account, because nobody knows who's in government and who's out of government. Because every party, when it suits them, act as though they're in opposition. And I think the collective responsibility is necessary to change that. I think another element of that is the oversight of the ministerial code. There is no mechanism. Indeed, I sit in the Standards and Privileges Committee, and we've written to the First and Deputy First Minister seeking guidance, seeking clarification as to about how we uphold the ministerial code. It's outside the remit of the Standards and Privileges Committee. It's outside the remit of the Standards Commissioner. And there's no mechanism to complain about a minister. You can complain about any member in this House. We're all subject in our MLA duties to the Standards Commissioner and the Committee on Standards and Privileges. But when it comes to a minister, if you wish to make a complaint, you can write to their party leader, but there is no investigation mechanism and there's no structures through which there can be accountability and transparency in holding ministers up to the standards set out of the Ministerial Code of Conduct. That unfortunately is not in the bill, and I would ask the member to look at that, and indeed the Assembly and Executive Review Committee, because I do think that's something, if we're to have collective responsibility, we also need accountability of ministers, and we need a mechanism for that. And I think that's something that could and should be explored through the committee and at consideration stage. Whilst, like Mr. Alistair, I would welcome a move towards voluntary coalition, and think it is the next logical step. I perhaps won't be so harsh in my commentary on the bill. I think whilst it's not the whole journey of normalising politics in Northern Ireland, I think it is a major step forward in that regard. I very much welcome the proposal to end community designation. The Green Party was very supportive of the Good Friday Agreement, but our one consistent criticism of it was the enshrining of the sectarian nature of Northern Ireland politics in these institutions by requiring community designation on election for each MLA. I think that was regrettable. And we know the other element of that, the petition of concern, has very much deviated from its original purpose in terms of protecting minority rights, and indeed has been used at times to try to prevent the extension of rights to minorities. So at times it's undermined the purpose it sought to serve. I think we must move on from it, and we must move away from community designation. And there is an inherent undemocratic nature to the petition of concern, whereby we have two tiers of MLAs. We have those who choose to designate as unionist or nationalist, whose vote counts in normal votes and in cross-community votes. And we have the bizarre situation whereby, as a leader of a cross-community party, my vote does not count in a cross-community vote. The votes of my constituents are no less than the votes of any other member in this House, and that's something. We can't have a system of two-tier MLAs, and we can't have a system of enshrined sectarianism. If we're to move away from the politics of us and them, we have to stop designating as us and them. We are 17 years on from the Good Friday Agreement. I was a wholehearted supporter. Indeed, I turned 18, I think it was approximately a month before the referendum, and my first ever vote was casting a yes vote in the referendum. And it was a proud day, and I was optimistic. And I think the hope, the expectation, and the potential has to some extent been wasted. Whilst yes, we have moved from a situation of conflict to one of relative peace, we have yet to make the step towards good governance. And I think this bill helps us take the next step on that journey. But I have consistently said from the 15th anniversary of the Good Friday Agreement, I've consistently said yes, we need to review it. Yes, we need to reform these institutions. And yes, we need to revitalise our peace process. But I've said all along that any major changes to what was agreed by the people of Northern Ireland through referendum should be put to the people of Northern Ireland to pass as a referendum. It's their agreement, it was the people's agreement, and it should not be changed without the people's consent. And I know that much of this would require Westminster legislation, and I would call on the Secretary of State to ensure that the public's consent is sought before we seek to radically reform the institutions created on the Good Friday Agreement with the consent of the people of Northern Ireland. We've seen in Scotland their referendum that it's re-energised politics. We've seen in the Republic of Ireland that through public vote, the thorny issue of equal marriage, I don't believe it should be an authority issue, I think for me it's a no-brainer, but what could be seen as a divisive issue was tackled maturely when the public view was sought. And indeed, we have a forthcoming referendum on our position in the European Union. I don't believe you can ever have too much democracy, but I believe in Northern Ireland we risk having a democratic deficit each time we tinker with the Good Friday Agreement without going back to the people. Unlike perhaps the SDLP, I am not opposed to major reform. I think it's needed. I think it was the right agreement. It was the right deal to get us to this stage. But I do think we need change to get us to the next stage, to get us through the next phase of our peace process. But I think we must bring the people with us in doing that. That said, we can never use the current structures as an excuse for poor governance. But I think it's clear that these structures make it more challenging. It allows for the structures allow for the dysfunction that is displayed when one minister takes to court another. And I think in that regard they need reform. There's no excuse for the poor record of this executive, but I think we have an opportunity to improve the vehicle through which we provide governance in Northern Ireland. In that regard, I welcome the bill. I commend the sponsor, Mr. McAllister, and I look forward to it passing through the various stages in this Assembly.
Call Mr. Basil McCree.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. There was a time, I remember it well, when talking about opposition was something radical, something new, something that everybody got quite excited about. In fact, I think it was the first time I actually hit the public eye in 2007, when just before a UUP conference, I said, having listened to a budget debate where we might as well not have been in the chamber, I said, this is ridiculous. We ought to go into opposition. And I've had a look through some of the papers, actually, since then, and there's a very interesting bit in the Irish News, actually, where it says the DUP have moved firmly into the ascendancy, but the UUP annual conference still manages to highlight some significant issues. And it mentions the fact that I thought we should go into opposition. A few months later, and this is why I'm grateful that I've got my colleague Mr. Alistair here, because he and I are quoted in December 2007, issues discussed included the sustainability of a mandatory coalition. Jim Alistair was clearly against it, though it does say he did not offer an alternative. But that was the debate then. Mr. McCrae repeating comments he previously made of the idea about going into the UUP going into opposition was also clearly on the record. You fast forward a few years to 2010, and we have, just to show that we're covering the whole of these lands, the Derry Journal ran with the headline, "Will the UUP go into opposition?" Basil McCrae went on and said, claimed the party's presence and executive was no more than a fig leaf for the DUP, who were excluding the UUP from most of the key decisions. I said it then, I stand by it now. What was interesting about that particular debate, or this document, and it's a pity that Mr. Lund is not here with us, is it goes on to say, with David Ford's elevation to Justice Minister on Monday, the Alliance Party, which had previously described itself as the opposition, is now within the executive. And now, as time goes on, not only are they not the opposition, they have two ministers in the executive, which is why it was quite interesting in the overtures from Mr Lund to Mr McAllister, would you not like to join us? And then, I'm not sure if Mr Lund was making himself available to be Speaker, but certainly there was a meeting of minds. And if we move a little further on to that, a little later in December 2010, when...
Order, please. I'm looking forward with tremendous excitement to the member talking about the bill.
Well, this is an opposition bill, and this is outlining what I was saying about opposition. And I'm just at a loss as to what my...
Order, please. I have no doubt the member is not in any way challenging the Speaker. And I will endeavour to give you all the flexibility I believe you deserve. I'm simply hinting to you that at some stage you might return to the bill.
And obviously, Deputy Speaker, I was in no way challenging. I was just seeking clarity on the matter. But I do think it is worthwhile saying, Mr Deputy Speaker, that this discussion about opposition has been ongoing for quite some considerable time. And some members have alluded to the fact that it is to Mr McAllister's credit that he has at least been able to bring this particular bill to the floor of the Assembly. And I think that is a reasonable position to state. But I do want to go on and talk about some of the issues that might have been addressed, because my point in all of this, Mr Deputy Speaker, was, and here again I agree with Mr Allister, is that this could have been a lot more radical, a lot more incisive. We could have tackled some of the outstanding issues. I note in the bill, I note in Mr McAllister's speech, that he has decided not to deal with the thorny issue of the hunt, because we apparently are not able for it. Actually, I do think that the hunt is a travesty. I know that other members here agree. I also note that Mr Agnew, in his contribution, was highlighting the problem that we have no way of holding ministers, which we do not appoint, to account. In fact, if you look at the fundamentals of the Belfast Agreement, you might say that the decision to put all of the executive powers in ministers, which are then unaccountable to this place, is actually at the root of our problems in trying to produce good government. I think, again, a point that Mr Allister was making. Now, if you were looking at some of the radical issues that I think need to be dealt with that remain outstanding, Deputy Speaker, I will say that when it comes to the Stormont House Agreement, the participants, item 73, the participants in the talks are very conscious that the integrity and credibility of this agreement is dependent on its effective and expeditious implementation. Accordingly, progress in implementing the provisions of this agreement must be actively reviewed and monitored. Now, I was at a meeting a few days ago that Mr Lund attended, and it was put to him, I think he was a little surprised by this, he can clarify, it was put to him that only the Alliance Party and I think Sinn Féin have ratified the Stormont House Agreement, that nobody else has agreed to this agreement. But, will indeed.
Yes, thank the member for giving way. The way it was put to me was that we were the only party who, through our internal party structures, had formally ratified the agreement. Others appear to have ratified it without actually saying so, or to some measure, but we were the only ones who had formally, through a process within the party, ratified it.
Thank you for that, Mr Lund. So it brings me to the point about, in relation to this bill about opposition arrangements, and in response to an earlier question, I think Mr McCartney mentioned it, the Stormont House Agreement, item 59, says that arrangements will be put in place by the Assembly by March 2015 to enable those parties which would be entitled to ministerial positions in the executive but choose not to take them up to be recognised as an official opposition. So quite a lot of what we're talking about in this bill is covered by the Stormont House Agreement. It also mentions, again mentioned in this bill, that the provision for financial and research assistance, and they're trying to keep the cost neutral, but actually in this particular part of the bill, Mr Deputy Speaker, the costs are to be additional. So there are some other points that I would like to ask about how we might deal with something a little bit more radical. Many members in this House have long called for a civic forum. In fact, it was part of the Belfast Agreement, item 34. And I would like to see a more radical approach about how we might bring in an opposition. Perhaps if we were dealing with opposition, we could look at we could look to Dublin, we could look to the Senedd, we could look to the way that they've actually got another House with people with different levels of responsibility, different levels of expertise, that they would actually give some guidance to this place. Because I can tell you, my fear about an opposition is it fundamentally comes down to numbers. Simply saying to somebody that you're an opposition or that you're going to get a wee bit more money is not going to change the basic electoral mathematics. Unless you have a fundamental change in structure, you are not going to see any difference. So I would like, when this bill goes through its committee stages, that we actually start to look at some really radical amendments, because you do have to have a change of function. And I am interested, just while we're on the point, of the point that Mr Agnew mentioned. I mean, if we are going to have a fundamental review, should we not put it to the public? I remember whenever I voted that I didn't really read the agreement. I was not a member of a political party, I was not in politics. I looked at it and said, I'd like to move forward, I'd like to put the past behind me, I'd like to do something different. But I didn't look at any of the detail, I didn't understand what it means. There is a challenge, however. You see, if you put any bill to the public of Northern Ireland at the moment and said, this is our plans for Stormont, I'm not sure you'd get any votes for it from anybody. Such is the state that we've got ourselves into. But maybe that is the point we have to do. Maybe that is the point that Mr Agnew was making, that we do need to get a form of radical engagement of the population, that politics is not something that you leave to people up here in the hill, that goes on here in behind closed doors, that people ignore. This is something actually that we have to get people engaged in. Now, if I put that out and say that is one of the issues that I would like dealt with, I also look at the bill and its point about smaller parties, about how we might deal with some further representation. People have talked about technical groups and such like. I must say, I thought it got a little bit confusing as to what you would be in a technical group for or why. Because it seems to me that if you're an independent, and let's understand that in the South, 18 members are independent. If you're an independent, how do you participate in a technical group if you don't want to? Why not just stand up and represent your own mandate? And I would also be more convinced by the arguments from around these chambers if, when you look at the speaking rights existing for those of us on these benches, that you didn't introduce rules in the business committee that prevented us from speaking. This is a decision not of the Westminster Parliament, not of the Secretary of State, not of somebody else. This is the business committee of this place that makes it the case that I think Mr Alistair is 35th, 36th, 37th, and you can't get to speak in a 1.5 hour debate. This is an attempt to silence those people that have a dissenting view. And I think that politics suffers because of that. And those of you that have got votes on the business community, you don't have to wait for this bill. You don't have to search around and see what's going on. You only have to change your own rules and let proper democratic debate take place in this House. So, I then move on to the issue of financial support. Again, I'm not sure if the sponsor of this bill has gone to the full detail on it, but I want to know, when he's talking about additional resources, does that include SPADs? Or is the Leader of the Opposition going to have a SPAD? Is he going to be on the Band B, the £92,000? Because, let's face it, if you are trying to hold to account the First Minister, who I think has got four SPADs, and the Deputy First Minister, who I think has got four SPADs, well then, we should have a SPAD for the Leader of the Opposition and the Leader of the Deputy Leader of the Opposition. Is this actually what we want? Do we really want to be putting more resources into those issues, or do we need a fundamental review of all of that issue? And I just think that the public will not wear if we try and come along and make changes of that in that manner. But, you know, if we were looking about reviewing things for an opposition, I do like the fact that in Westminster they present to the public the name of every single SPAD and how much money they earn. That seems to me to be the sort of open and democratic position that we want to do, and perhaps the member will take that on board. So I want to come to perhaps what is the most interesting issue for me, is the issue about the concept of cross-community designation. Because for those people that follow these things, it was an issue that vexed Mr. McAllister and I a few years ago. It was an issue where we in NI21 decided that, all things being considered, it would not change my position on the constitution issue, but I dislike labels. I do not want to be labelled by other people about who I am or what I am. Designation is a fundamental mistake in the democratic proceedings of this Assembly. I said it then, I say it now. The issue, I think the quote was, Mr. McAllister said that it puts us right into no man's land with the Alliance Party. And yet, here we are now saying, I hear it collectively, I hear it around, designation is a bad idea. Why do you need to have some stamp on you that says unionist or nationalist? Is it not obvious from what you say, from what you do, from the motions that you bring forward? Do you really need this to happen? And yet what it does, it enshrines some form of sectarian politics. And I think that we ought to do more about that. We ought to do it now. So when this bill goes through committee, when we've lauded the sponsor for having the foresight to bring forward this bill, I hope that we really deal with the technical issues that we have to look out for. I want to see, what does an opposition really mean? And can you do it in here when there's perhaps only six people providing an opposition? And is it really the case that if you get to be a minister with untrammelled ministerial powers, that you're going to give that up to be an opposition? Because I don't think so. So I will say to you here and now, Deputy Speaker, there are debates taking place elsewhere. You look at this chamber, thankfully a little fuller than it was earlier on, but you look at this chamber and realise this chamber is not the decision-making body. This chamber can talk all it likes, but it is not going to change anything. But unless we do, unless we find some resolution, then we will lose the confidence of the people of Northern Ireland. And I do agree with Stephen Agnew that things have got so bad now in terms of the people's perception of this place, that nothing short of a renegotiation and another referendum will restore credibility in the institutions of Northern Ireland.
Well, Ms. Clare Sugden.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. First, I wish to congratulate Mr. McAllister on bringing what I believe to be one of the most important bills to this House since the Good Friday Agreement. I'm disappointed, although not surprised, that the gravity of this bill is not being acknowledged in the way that I believe it should be. On one side of this House, we have the largest political party deciding that their dirty, inconsistent mess is more important than moving Northern Ireland forward. Directly opposite, we have the second largest party, fearful to break the mould of the Good Friday Agreement because perhaps Northern Ireland might actually stand a chance. Mr Deputy Speaker, I think we should break the mould of the Good Friday Agreement. Because I am reluctant to say that it has served its purpose in bringing an end to the violence. Because although we have come far, we have still a way to go in addressing our troubled past. Indeed, it's not my intention to undermine the Good Friday Agreement. It was necessary and it was the only way at the time given the intractable differences of those involved. In 17 years, however, I hope we have grown, I hope we've learned, and although clearly the differences do remain the same, thankfully today is very different to where we were in 1998, which is why I do think we need to break the mould of the Good Friday Agreement, because it has served its purpose of where we can go from now. The Good Friday Agreement, it had its failings, of course it did, it wasn't perfect. But the political nonsense which is currently making fools of us all as members of this House, I believe, are the outworkings of those failings. Ultimately, there is a lack of accountability. We made those concessions for peace, and right or wrong, we now ultimately have peace. But now is the time to start making Northern Ireland work on a structural level. Subsequent agreements that have been cast in the Good Friday Agreement mould, they're not working. The latest, the Stormont House Agreement, you know, has yet to be even removed from its box or even its wrapper. We do need something different that puts the people of Northern Ireland first. And I take Mr Agnew's point. Perhaps we do take this to a referendum. The Good Friday Agreement was decided upon in a referendum. And maybe that change now needs the substance of the people of Northern Ireland behind it, because this House certainly doesn't have the substance of the people of Northern Ireland behind it. But I'm not saying throw the Good Friday Agreement in the bin. I'm not saying throw any of the work that we've done up until now in the bin. You know, it should remain a very important part of our history. But now is the right time to create something new. Mr McAllister's bill is a start. It's not perfect. There are aspects which I certainly disagree with, particularly in respect of the Speaker and how we elect him. But one day I will advocate that we break this mould that he is trying to put before us today for something better in Northern Ireland. And that's what we should strive for. We should always be striving for something better. And that doesn't mean changing what has passed. That means building on it. And I think this is essentially what we're doing here. We need to be brave today and in the coming stages of this bill. The essence of this bill is scrutiny. After representing the people, the role of a member of the Legislative Assembly, that's MLAs for those of you who don't know, is to effectively scrutinise the work of the Northern Ireland Government, the Northern Ireland Executive, to ensure that they are making the right decisions on behalf of the people of Northern Ireland. This House doesn't scrutinise the Northern Ireland Government effectively. It can't. Mr Deputy Speaker, the most effective scrutiny that comes from this House is in this corner. Since becoming an MLA, Mr Deputy Speaker, I have asked more questions than any other MLA in Northern Ireland, which is something I'm very proud of. We independent Claire from East Londonderry has done her job 100% more than any other members of this House. To add to that, I've asked more questions than the other MLAs of my constituency put together. So we can do the job if we want to do. We have three private members' bills, a fourth when Mr Alistair tables his bill next week, coming from this corner. What unites us? What is the success of this corner? It's because we're not in government. We have the integrity that we can challenge without prejudice, and that is important to get the truth for the people of Northern Ireland so that we can move forward and make things better. Even the Ulster Unionist Party have been more effective since coming out of government, and let's hope they stay that way. Now, in respect of some of the aspects of the bill, and I won't go into detail of everything because I think that's an opportunity that we do that at further consideration. The technical groups within the opposition, yeah, I would quite happily work with most of the men in this corner, all of them, I'll say it that way. Because as an independent, I am always the last to speak on an issue. This will go back to John whenever I'm finished. So it has made things difficult for me. There are issues within my own constituency that I have been unable to speak on because I'm always the last to speak. I've been timed out long before they get to me. That's not fair. The 3,003 first preference voters that were entrusted to me by my predecessor deserve a voice. And I think the current mechanism doesn't allow for that.
Will the member give way?
Yes.
Will the member just, for the record, explain, because constituents will ask why you're not speaking out on issues. And I think people need to understand it is because you're prevented by the standing orders from being able to speak. And I think you should make the point clear.
Yes, thank you for that contribution. Yes, it's entirely true. People say to me, so Claire, I haven't seen you in Stormont today. What are you doing up there? And I says, well, I'm doing a lot more than one of the particular parties in this Assembly. But the truth be told is that more often than not, I prepare speeches, I prepare contributions, but I get timed out. Sometimes it's not even worth having an opinion. So I do it in other ways. I do it in questions. Just think what I could do if I realistically had an opportunity to table motions that I could get onto the floor of this House. We'd probably be here a lot longer than we currently are. Speaking rights, I suppose, kind of ties in with the technical groups in that being part of a technical group, would it give us more opportunity? And I suppose from the point of view, people say to me, well, why would I want to work with other people who don't necessarily share the same views as me? It is based on structure and it is based on having a voice. And if a technical group provides for that, I'm quite happy to do that. I think one of the biggest failures of Northern Ireland politics is that people think if you challenge someone from within your own party, that's seen as a failure. It's not. It should actually be a strength. If you can challenge someone from within your own party and move forward with that, that actually makes you stronger. And I wish other parties would say that, because we'd maybe start getting some truth out of here. The naming of the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, well, this is quite controversial. I do agree that we should perhaps call it what it is. Martin McGuinness is as equally the First Minister as, Peter Robinson, Arlene Foster currently is. And it might spare a few blushes next year when Martin McGuinness is likely to be the leader of the largest party in Northern Ireland, and he is likely to take the First Minister's role. It's reality. It's where we are. I agree with Mr. Alistair. I do think this bill could go further, and indeed now I'm looking into tabling amendments which will hold ministers to account. And certainly I would look forward to working with Mr. Agnew if he wishes to table those amendments, so that we can actually hold ministers who are currently perverting their pledge of office and when they take on that role. So, to conclude, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I do welcome this bill to the House. I think it could go further, but we can do that later, but it is certainly a start, and I look forward to the further consideration stage. Thank you.
Call Mr. John McAllister to conclude and wind up the debate. Mr. McAllister.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'm grateful to colleagues for all participating in the debate. If I could just, and I'll try briefly, I made the comments in opening this debate that this, to my mind, was a carefully thought out package. For me, this works when you put it in as a whole, that you have the collectiveness of a government working together, you have an opposition, and you have a place that you can hang the rights for members in opposition. I will say to Mr. McCartney, who talked about linking in to De Hunt, and that you could do some of this, or maybe most of it, by standing orders. Again, that goes back to the point he made about, in response to my point about the 1929 changes to the electoral system. It becomes much harder to change standing orders if they are based in primary legislation, and therefore we guarantee those rights of the Assembly and of any opposition that we create that flows from this. And I think Mr. Kennedy also mentioned those. So those are some of the changes that I think would be welcome. Because they're based in primary legislation, I think that's very, very important. He and I think Mr. Rogers talked about Good Friday Agreement proofing the legislation. As a supporter of the Good Friday Agreement, I don't have a problem with that. I do firmly believe what I propose in this is based around the principles of inclusivity, and inclusivity not only in government through the De Hunt process, except where I want to set a threshold on that and give people enhanced rights in opposition, but that's inclusivity in the political process, and I think that is vital, and therefore I think the test he's setting, I think, and I'm confident that the bill will meet. Also, a point one of his colleagues made to me one time, Deputy Speaker, was in Sinn Féin's role as an opposition party in Doyle Éireann, that during the recent debate about water, when you added when you added collectively all of the amendments that Sinn Féin members, I think, had tabled, they ended up with having something like 4 seconds per amendment as an average to address them. That, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is when an executive has too much power over the legislative branch, and that shouldn't happen, and shouldn't happen in this chamber. And therefore, I actually think the way they've been, Sinn Féin have been using opposition in the Dáil isn't a good example of holding a government to account. Mr. Rogers very much welcomed the bill, welcomed topical questions, chair of the PAC, Public Accounts Committee, funding, very much welcomed de Hunt, and again mentioned the Good Friday Agreement and the inclusivity. And I can, without repeating what I said, that's I think it is as important being included in the political community, not just in government. Talked about being nervous about the changes of about community designation, but I do think was open to that debate, and I very much welcome his comments around that. Again, some nervousness around the size of technical groups. And I do think his quote that he used from Seamus Mallon, former Deputy First Minister, about being at peace with ourselves and setting out integrity and vision. I think that's what this bill is about, is setting out a vision for the future of how we address all of the problems, and not just the bugbears that always come back to bite us, but all of the problems, whether it's education, underachievement, economic reform, all of the things that we have to do and do significantly better. Mr. Kennedy, certainly in welcoming the bill, talked about the power to vote a party out of government, 17 years, and I agree with that point that the Assembly has not evolved at the speed or the pace. Indeed, as a society, we may even think that the Assembly is probably significantly behind our society in many issues. The structures, rather than bringing people in, or putting people off, and I agree with Mr. Kennedy's point on that, because not only are we putting people off our voter engagement, if we even, for those of us in our second term here and those that have served longer, will know that the amount of engagement by different lobby groups and charities is not nearly as significant as it was during certainly my first term here. And Mr. Kennedy rightly made the point about revitalising the Assembly. And he did talk about, he referred to Lord MP's attempts in the House of Lords and that rights based in legislation. And that's why the bill is here, because it bases those rights in legislation, that it leaves it very difficult for a future executive, a future government, to take those rights away, as indeed was the worry that Mr. McCartney raised as well. So that is why it is good and useful to have. Technical groups and within the opposition are looking at resources. He did mention the sectarian nature of the headcount of OFM-DFM, but was overall supportive of reform of the Assembly and Executive, and indeed as a minister of almost 5 years' service, was probably well placed to make comment on it. Turning now to Mr. Lund, who welcomed the bill, and it will, I agree with this point, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it will test the Assembly. There are challenges in there around the petition of concern, community designation. He welcomed the opposition and did question the need for a government. And at times that's a point, I think it was a point as well made by Mr. Agnew, at sometimes we do have a government in opposition, they just happen to be all the one people. And that's the really disappointing thing, and what gets us into such difficulty with making decisions, that everyone is in government and in opposition. Those should be two very clear, very distinct roles. Chair of the PAC, the Finance Committee, I think he was questioning, and Mr. Bradley in an intervention talked about the budget process. I have to say, Deputy Speaker, I agree with Mr Lund and Mr Bradley's intervention, and it was during the opening speech I made mention, Mr Cree's in the chamber, that this has been a long-standing bugbear of Mr Cree's, that our financial process, that we have to do everything. We end up doing it by accelerated passage. We get information all at the last minute. That would be my hope as to why you would separate out a budget process and hence a budget committee and a finance committee. The finance could handle all of the other stuff about rating policies, about personnel, about voluntary exit scheme. But your budget committee would focus on the budget process. And the budget process changes, Deputy Speaker, that have been long talked about and long championed by people like Mr Cree, would come to some sort of fruition at this stage. Because I think our budget process, most people in this chamber seem to agree that it is wholly inadequate now. Mr Lund also talked about, I suppose, getting the maturity and growing up. I long believed that, Deputy Speaker, that Northern Ireland is coming close to 100 years old. I'm not quite sure we've really grown up, or we still seem to look somewhat of the teen and early 20s that sort of not long left for university and still has the apron strings fairly tied to them and don't want to do much without somebody giving them the support or sending money. You know, like, I'm sure some of you that have young people at university might get the call every once in a while to send more money across, but that essentially seems to be where we're stuck. We've never matured into the politics of grown-up government, of actually dealing with the issues, or indeed coming up with policy innovations that would tackle that. Our one policy agreement seems to be that London should send us more money, and what we would do with it would be up to anybody's guess. But that, I do think it is time, and this bill presents that opportunity for Northern Ireland to come of age and to grow up and to govern ourselves and to meet the challenges of that government. Mr. Alistair obviously was somewhat surprised that we would need a debate on opposition, and of course there should be an opposition, and at least the bill is moving in the right direction. And I could have comfortably predicted the one area that he would denounce me for would be staying wedded to haunt. And I would wish it sometimes that we were in a position to move away from it, but to haunt guarantees parties of a certain size their entry into government. It is then up to those parties to accept that responsibility. And there is a responsibility with being in government. It is easier to be in opposition in certain ways and always say this is terrible or that's no good or whatever. Being in government carries a huge responsibility. Being a government backbencher must be a terrible burden with not much perks of the job and all the criticisms. And that's why if you use that to haunt system, it must be that parties face up to the challenge, negotiate a programme for government and move on. It certainly is, his support was very much welcome on moving away from designation, the nature of some of that, the tribalness of designation. Technical groups, he rightly pointed out, being part of one in the European Parliament, and that the Dáil has it. Nuireamh Mór and Down Council have a technical group, which is the third largest grouping in the party. No political affiliations between the members involved, but it includes, I think, an independent Republican, the Alliance Party, a couple of other independents as well, and they qualify then for extra speaking time in the council. And that is something, I think, to be welcomed, that if the six of us or any collection of six people wanted to do that, wanted to trigger extra rights, wanted to trigger a seat on the business committee, then of course a technical group. That doesn't mean we're signing up to agree with each other on anything. It just simply is a mechanism to use to make sure your opposition is, and a technical group is of a certain size, that they access the rights, they enhance speaking rights, they access to the business committee, and that's where I think it's welcome. It could certainly change the dynamic and answers the other points from Ms Hogan and I think Mr McRae, that it would guarantee members in this corner a speaking slot in every debate, and that I think changes it quite dramatically, because I know certainly, and Deputy Speaker, you and your colleagues on many occasions do your level best to try and get as many people in and as wide a cross-section of views as possible, but many, many occasions that isn't possible to get any in from this corner, indeed, and sometimes on a certain budget motion where it's a time limited. I think because I had an amendment to it, I was possibly the only one from these benches that actually spoke on it. I would also, I'm pleased that Mr Alistair agrees around the OFM, DFM and renaming of that. His point around giving real effect to this and getting a lot of the schedule passed, I think the parts we can do here, yes, are great for the opposition. The prize of getting the schedule and so much of that through is actually that we change how our executive works. We challenge that. We build in collective cabinet government. We change, remove community designation. We put in a threshold. We change the dynamic of how this place works. I think that's vitally important. Mr. Agnew's comments round and he's quite right when he opened up, Deputy Speaker, and said that probably many people told you, you can't do this. You're right, I heard that quite a few times. Can't do it. That's not get round. How do you get round the competencies? We need Westminster. And as I said at the opening part of the debate, Westminster, and I think three different debates in the House of Lords, nailed that firmly down both. Baroness Randerson speaking on behalf of the then coalition government and Lord McAvoy speaking on behalf of the Labour opposition made it quite clear they would not act without the Northern Ireland Assembly and Executive being the initiator of that action. This, Deputy Speaker, is the way to initiate that. This bill is the vehicle to do that. Again, the legislation not required for all. I do think in basing it in standing orders, when it's based in primary legislation, that means it is much more than just grace and favour of the executive arm of government, and make sure that the government is listening. Collective responsibility. I mean, Mr Agnew's in favour of this, and I think you've only to look at many government policies and you quickly see that they read like a set of football results in dealing with them, and that's why we have to move away from that. We've parties of government vote against the budget, which would bring down governments in other places, and they can do it without any great responsibility because they know the big two have enough to carry it, and that is not being in government and being a responsible party of government, and that's why I think that that collective cabinet and that change in culture, because too often, Deputy Speaker, in this House, members get up and ministers get up and speak as if the government, when they think about the government, they're thinking about London or Dublin. They're not thinking that they are the government of Northern Ireland. And that is a sea change, and something I'm actually keen and agree with Ms Agnew. I'd be quite keen to hear it referred to in the future as the Government of Northern Ireland. He's looking round at ministerial code and the accountability. I think he's well placed on the Standards and Privileges Committee, and I would certainly welcome anything like that. And I think Ms Sugden mentioned as well, anything like that, I think, is to the good. And he's right on petitions of concern, and he knows I've often said to him that you do know when you sign a petition of concern, Mr Agnew, that your vote doesn't count. And that's something that I think is inherently wrong, neither does Mr Lund. So there's 9 members in this chamber that their votes don't count. And at that point, I think, therefore, we do need to move and change. As is point about a referendum, I'm never overly convinced. I mean, if I thought, looking back in 1998, that 71.25% of the population voting yes had put the thing to a settled issue, there, and everybody turned around and went, well, there's the people have spoken, isn't it great? We've spent 17.5 years fighting about it from the referendum, so I'm never entirely convinced on at times quite technical changes as to whether it's entirely appropriate for a referendum. My only concern, and Ms Sugden brought up as well around having that, I'm not opposed. If somebody wants to hold it and somebody thinks it's a good idea, I'm just not convinced that in a representative democracy, this is the place. This is the place, in my view, to do that. Turning to Mr McRae for his contribution, I sort of gathered the point that Mr McRae was wanting to very much sort of say that he'd invented opposition. I will quote to him 2 things initially. And this is from his speech when he launched for the leadership of the Ulster Unionist Party in 2010. Pledge number 1 is no ministry until the party's success is assured. I intend to lead the party on the basis that the leader of the UUP will be First Minister. Until that goal is achieved, I will not accept any other ministry. I will view this commitment after the next Westminster election. I'm determined to turn this party around, and so on. Pledge number 2, the UUP will take the Education Ministry as first choice. I'm not sure that's entirely consistent with what he said, but he goes on that the foundation of any value-added economy is about education and training, which is fine. But those two points would certainly nail the myth, Deputy Speaker, that Mr McRae invented opposition. I would say he went up. Yes, sir.
The member just informed the House that when he was trying to bring a private member's bill through on procurement, that he came to me and asked if I would take it over so that you could bring forward this private member's bill.
I'm happy to confirm that, Deputy Speaker, and I look forward to an update on how he got on with this public procurement bill. I'll not take one now. You'll get your chance. The Deputy Speaker, I would also, Mr McRae also asked about, made some comment about designation being important to me. I think if the record's checked, Mr McRae is still designated as a unionist. So it's obviously was such a pressing thing to change in May 2014, he couldn't even get that done. And could not, I will in a second, could it?
The Deputy Speaker inform the House as to at what stages you're able to change designation in this place?
I would ask the member to seek advice outside of the chamber. And could I encourage all members to come back to the bill that is in front of us today? Mr McAllister.
I'm grateful, Deputy Speaker, and around the issue of community designation in the bill, I would just quote from the members' party website, which was up until the end of March and April this year, that said, we have repeatedly said that where we are required to designate as unionist, nationalist or other in the Assembly, we will designate as unionist. So I don't know what changed his mind. I think he well knows the issues that NI21 floundered on. Deputy Speaker, round the other issues about technical groups, I am surprised that he is not as supportive of technical groups. I would say to him it isn't compulsory to be in a technical group. If he didn't want to be part of that, he wouldn't have to be. It's not, or indeed if anyone didn't want him to be part of it, he wouldn't have to be either way. Financial support, he asked about a SPAD for the Leader of the Opposition. I think financial support in these matters is best left to a review panel to look at. I did highlight at the opening of the debate that if you were to move from things, if you wanted to keep it as cost neutral to this assembly, you could quite easily move all or a percentage of ministerial salaries being paid by the departments that they're responsible for rather than this assembly, because that costs £767,000 a year to this assembly by the time you add in national insurance contributions and pensions. I would say he also mentioned about giving up ministerial office and power. That's why there's a threshold built in. De Hont is your way in. I am surprised that he's talking about De Hont being such a travesty. I have to say I expected that from Mr. Alistair, but not from Mr. McCrae. De Hont, and he would well know that we are not in a position to move away from De Hont. He would well know that I respect all of the parties here, their mandate. I respect that De Hont will and be used for a considerable time to come as people's right in the government. I'm not about trying to gang up on any one party to put them out of government. The challenge in that is to respond and to be responsible and to act like you're in government. But therefore, De Hont, and I will defend sticking with De Hont in this. Around the Civic Forum, I've no great issues around suggestion around the Civic Forum. Representative democracy, I would say this place has to be the supremacy, the supreme seat of representative democracy in Northern Ireland. Could a Civic Forum add value, add something to it, add some ideas? Absolutely. Of course it could. And as for the point about renegotiating all, so one time that I have to say, Deputy Speaker, that we have effectively been negotiating all of my life, not just my adult life, but I was born in February 1972. We have been negotiating all of that period. We've been from Sunningdale, when I was a very, very small boy, right through from constitutional conventions to rolling devolution in the 80s, to the Hume Adams talks, to talks here in the early 90s, to the ceasefires, to the Good Friday Agreement, to every country estate in the United Kingdom. We've an agreement nearly named after it. We've St Andrews agreements, the Hillsborough, the agreement at Hillsborough, the Stormont House / Stormont Castle agreement. We have them all. And where are we at this point? Because this, Deputy Speaker, this bill provides a vehicle to do that. It provides a vehicle and a timely way that you have to either vote yes or no at some point for. We have to decide, do we want to reform this place or do we want to continue on the way we've been going? We have to decide. It's up to every one of us, to every one of our parties to decide, do we want to continue with what we've had over the past number of years, with indecision, constant crisis, which crisis here, another crisis, will the Assembly and Executive survive to next week? We have to decide, have we had enough of that brinkmanship? We have to decide, do we want to do government? Do we actually want to be responsible for ourselves and our own future and our children's future? That's what the crux of this bill is about, deciding, can we have a future that we work together? Can we have a future that demands partnership in government and scrutiny from an opposition and providing an alternative? There's no There's nothing in the bill that says opposition parties have to work together. There's nothing that says that the UUP as an opposition have to work with the SDLP or the Alliance or any of us. But I think the electoral advantage is to starting to work together, starting to look like an alternative government. That changes the dynamics in here. That changes the way that people think. One of the reasons that so many people predicted that we might have an election by now, or we could have an election in November or any time, is because so many people knew that nothing would change, that it would make no difference to one jot. The same faces, largely the same parties, a few seats might change here and there, but we would come back to face the same problems. How do we deal with all of these issues? This forms a mechanism to do it, and I accept some of the issues that can't be dealt with, the government may have to park, but get on and do the stuff that you can agree with, and do government, not endless peace process negotiation. That's what we've done in the last 18 years, is government by peace process negotiation. It has been the peace process. We now, by next May, will have the first people casting their vote, if they can make it out to a polling station, that will have been born after the Good Friday Agreement and of that era. So the first truly post-conflict generation coming of age to vote. This is a chance to, by the next Assembly term, to change the dynamic of our Northern Ireland Government and an Assembly, make it fit for purpose, use the bill as the vehicle to make that change happen and to get on and give real purpose and direction and meaning to what a government does with the scrutiny, the robust challenge and scrutiny that an opposition could bring. I beg to move the Assembly and Executive Reform Bill.
Members, the question is that the second stage of the Assembly and Executive Reform Assembly Opposition Bill be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The next item on the order paper is a motion regarding the committee stage of the Assembly and Executive Reform Assembly Opposition Bill. The motion will be treated as a business motion, and therefore there will be no debate. Clerk, please read the motion.
That as provided for in Standing Order 33.1, the Assembly and Executive Reform Assembly Opposition Bill, NIA Bill 62/11-16, stands referred to the Assembly and Executive Review Committee.
I call Peter Weir to move the motion. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The next item.